morning, Breakfast Clubbers! Are we there yet?
No.
This is, I'm going to tell you a very short story because we want to get right to Dean. He's going to have to leave in a half hour because he's a Republican precinct, whatever the hell, you know, so he's got to go do that today. The infiltrating. Infiltrating. It's all good. I'm going to explain the history here at Aaron.
Hey, Big Johnny, man.
I'm going to explain the big the history of gun control and gun activism and everything here in Arizona. A lot of people you think you know,
but you don't know.
Okay. Behind the scenes stuff that goes on, as always. There was an article that we had in the magazine, the Easy, and it went out last night. That's what you saw, the cover that I had up there, and we'll talk about later. But there was an article, James Babb from Philadelphia, he made the point, he goes, you know, it's like you have blind men going up to the elephant and trying to describe it. You know, the one guy's got, oh, it's round, and it's kind of, you know, Trump, you know, let's get a wall, and, oh, it's a tail, you know, that kind of stuff. Sighted guy, hey man, you know, you can see the whole thing, you know, you describe, you know, it's an elephant. Oh, by the way, you're blind. And what he was equating is that America has gone around, they're so focused on the little stuff, they're missing the big picture. You know, well, the government is this. No, it's this. It's good this, it's bad this, it's this, it's this. Libertarians kind of go, whoa, man, could it be Staten? Now, yeah, no. There's a big story behind that, too. I'll tell you that later. I want you to know about how Freedom's Phoenix works real quick, and you understand what Dean's going to do. Freedom's Phoenix, originally, we came up with the logo, the idea, everything back in 96. We were just waiting for video to hit the internet. When video hit, we go, oh, it's all over, because they're thinking that when they're doing the Fox News and the F-15s flying through and the explosions kind of, ooh, yeah, fear jet landing started, okay? Then they do their blah, 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 blah. They did not see that individuals with these smartphones sitting there doing a video, doing a 4409 thing with the guy standing and, you know, spitting in their faces, you're yelling with a badge and a gun and all that kind of, they didn't think that would be able to compete with them. It never occurred to them that, you know, you have a South Korean guy doing a Gundam-style video, gets over 1 billion hits in a month. A billion hits on one video from a guy doing it in South Korea.
They were all in Asia.
I'm going, wow, it's all over for the bad guys, okay? So if you can, you know, just get in the mind, what is it that, you know, gets people to do that? What events, what kinds of things? But we knew that the structure for Freedom's Phoenix had in our mind in 94. Building up for 2 years from 94 to 96, the concept of the structure and everything for Freedom's Phoenix was originally going to be for SAFE. Second Amendment is for everyone. Are you a safe gun owner? Are you unsafe? Are you an unsafe legislator? I mean, we've been doing this for years before, and we were the ones that started the Concealed Carry Initiative in 94. It was so popular, and so many, you know, it's like eight across, six deep at every at the home improvement show or something to sign the petition that the legislature went, man, we've got to get ahead of this thing. So they created the permit system. Well, behind the scenes, there was a whole bunch of stuff going on. We'll talk about that today and how it affected Dean. Now, on Freedom's Phoenix, you go to what's called special editions. So you have just replications of the front page, but for, you know, certain things that you wanted to do. SAFE, second one, that's the kind of different, you know, variations of the logo. Now what we've done is we create editions where we could just pull stories from the front page, and we have gun rights as a category, thousands of stories, and we take those and we put them up on this special edition. So when you go to safegunowners.org.com or Second Amendment for Everyone, whatever, boom, it goes there. Well, man, did my traffic go like this after Sandy Hook, okay? So we started formulating, I had Larry Pratt after he kicked the crap out of Piers Morgan on CNN. I go, Larry, come on the show, man, tell me so I can lay accolades all over y'all, but okay. So I was so glad to see that they didn't compromise, and it wasn't always like that. You go back 20 years or so of us doing this, there are other things. Now Dean,
can we talk about the DR?
Yeah. Okay, Dean Pleasant, county treasurer when I was county chairman of the Libertarian County Party back in the early 90s or mid 90s. He was a rifle competition team called Viper Team. They would compete in AR-15 doing whatever shooting kind of, they loved that. Well, him and his friends had a newsletter. I mean, this is how clandestine they were. And excuse the language, but it was S.A.F.E. newsletter, and it stood for Suicidal Hippie Fucks, okay? So they weren't taking it that seriously, okay? So they did this newsletter, and it was about their exploits and different things that they do, but at the same time, they're being kind of a little clandestine. We know it's coming. We're going to get ready. We're going out in the desert, and we're learning how to blow up ammo in 5-gallon buckets and stuff, and, you know, it just makes good TV. Janet Napolitano was assistant attorney general. They wanted a big, it's like a Waco, Ruby, all this stuff, just a big thing. It's a fundraising kind of thing. So they always had, it was Arizona, Michigan, Montana, and Georgia. And it was kind of round robin they did. They had a lot of, you know, Second Amendment kind of guys, and they'd just do whenever they need headlines. So it was Arizona's turn. They had a couple of infiltrators for a year or so. They're trying, hey, we got to go rob banks. No, that's not what we are. We're kind of, you know, whatever. And, of course, he's like one of two or three libertarians out of, you know, a bunch of Republicans. But, it's a libertarian thing. Of course it is. You know, we're at least 10-1 in influence, you know, for us anyway. So what happened was they made a big deal out of all this. He did 5.5 years in federal prison for conspiring to teach.
Oh.
The terrorism bill that was passed, they had it. It passed. It's signed, but they got the indictment, or the warrant, or the indictment, or the jury or something, you know, like a day or two before it actually took effect, so they couldn't charge them what they wanted to, which would have gotten 20 years. Now, Chuck Knight, right, was his name? Chuck Knight, he said, I'm not pleading, he goes, not guilty, not guilty, not guilty, not guilty, not guilty. The judge instructions of the jury, it goes on and on and on, and they go, you have to, and this, and that, and so on, and they liked him, they knew it was all crap, but technically he did know and do something, I don't know what it was, and they go, okay, guilty on this. Boom! Send him to prison, years, and so on, the jury started crying. They're out, I had no idea, I mean, all of a sudden you start, during that trial, we're putting FIJA information out everywhere, to the point that the judge is going, pay no attention to the orange flyers.
Oh my gosh.
So we printed them about 14 other colors. So I put them there. I'm like, seriously, that's your game? So you have to understand, we've been in this for a long time. It's called the Viper Reserve. We used the internet for the first time, really, that we were aware of in the late 90s, where we archived the chronology of everything. Just like you're seeing what's going on with a lot of these different shootings and so on. We had a chronology, we had t-shirts that we did, and he had a lawsuit against Napolitano for, what, 30, 60 million or some crap? You know, it was just, you know, from all the false, even Koppel on Nightline's going, yeah, this is not what they said it was. But we didn't have YouTube then. So the best we could do is we'd get, you know, VHS of that, and we save it, and we start loading it on the website and all this kind of stuff. So when I was on CNN, I don't know, a couple of years ago when Obama came and Chris and AR-15 stuff, black man with AR-15, oh my God. You know, when I went on CNN, I mentioned all this. I go, well, we went through this before. Now, Napolitano was assistant attorney general, and they made this out of the Viper thing that really wasn't there, and, you know, blah, blah, blah. Well, SNBC, everybody wants me, they want me on, but they wouldn't do me live. I go, nope, I'm going to do live, did CNN, you get one bite, and that's it. Next, just do CNN or Hancock, you'll see. But what happened is that MSNBC, they jumped on all the liberal, like Truth Dig and Common Dream, Daily Cause, all these went after the Viper Reserve. Ooh, there was a Viper thing? Well, then they all started reading it. Now, this is something that was, I don't know, almost 15 years ago.
96.
And they go, damn. Well, maybe we don't want to talk about that. Yeah, that's what I thought. A couple weeks ago, I get an email from Metal Flowers Media or something out of Hollywood, and they're a well-known, you know, documentary kind of whatever crew. Oh, Mr. Hamp, we want to talk to you about, we're doing a militia documentary. Oh, we need you all safe. Why? Because when the Southern Poverty Law Center, we'll get to this after we let Dean go. But there is so much more to this than you guys read. And I see what's coming. Darren freaking T, how much money you want to bet me? And there is a difference now than back then. And we'll talk about it. But what they're going to do and how they're going to do it, you know, they already have a template. Dean is, man, he knows. Dean Pleasant.
So as already talked about, is this on or can you all hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, how's that?
Better.
Okay. So as Ernie said, I've been in the gun culture almost all my life. It was my main area of activism, which drew me to the Libertarian Party over 20 years ago. So I call myself a gun dude. I hang out with other gun dudes and be that sort of thing. So anything having to do with gun control, gun legislation, whatever, it's what I'm on top of. And of course, it's been in the news lately with the shootings in Connecticut. It's renewed the gun control debate, which essentially has been dormant since 2004 when the assault weapons ban of 1994 expired, and really it was dormant before that for a long time too. The reason it's been dormant is because when they passed this assault weapon ban in 1994, it really hurt the Democrats to do it. You have to understand that just like immigration is to the Republican Party, something they just can't not talk about but hurts them when they do. The same thing is true of gun control for the Democratic Party. They can't help but talk about it, they can't help but pursue it, but it hurts them almost every time. And so they learned that lesson pretty severely after 1994, and they kind of laid off of it, but they have their diehard activists, and not all of them necessarily just within the Democratic Party, just chomping at the bit and frustrated they weren't getting any action on gun control, and they've been harping and harping and harping and wanting something to happen. Especially, they thought it was going to happen in 2008 when Obama got elected. A lot of gun dudes thought it was going to happen in 2008. And from 2008 to 2012, everybody's waiting for the big gun control push that never came. So when Connecticut happened, you had a lot of pent-up energy on the side of the proponents of gun control. They put out their full court press, and here it comes. Obama himself has said, he has pledged to those activists in his party and to key governors and other people with whom gun control is a big concern, he has promised that by the end of February, we will have it. What is it? Well, Dianne Feinstein seems to be the one who is leading the charge on this. She has introduced legislation which would roll assault weapons, so-called, in under the National Arms 1934, which gun guys like me refer to as the NFA. And what is the NFA? Well, there's a lot of history behind that. Essentially, the NFA is the Federal Rules and Regulations and Laws under Taxation Authority that machine guns and other things like grenades and explosives are regulated. Some people were surprised to learn you can own a machine gun as an American citizen in most states. Arizona is one of those states. You have to jump through these regulations and these hoops to do it, but yes, you can own a machine gun. You can own a tank. You can own a flamethrower. These things are available, but they're regulated under the NFA. How did that come about? You have to go back to the 1900s when socialism was first on the move big time in this country. There were labor strikes, there were riots, there was a lot of violence in America organized because of the push for socialism and unions and labor from 1900s on up through the 20s. Relative prosperity of the 20s right before the crash in 29, that all kind of abated because everybody was living well, even those who were just the lowly workers. But there had been decades of violence. And a lot of people were concerned about it, mostly Republicans. The Republicans who, you know, tended to, as they always have tended to, represent the moneyed interests, you know, the mines, the banks, and so forth, they were very concerned about this international labor union, this international labor movement, socialism and communism as we know it. And they were very concerned about some of the violence that had occurred. Some of it had been very bloody, hadn't all gone the way of law and order and those in charge. And there had been talk in Republican circles back then, at that time, about disarming the public. People don't talk about that today. But modern gun control in this country began first being talked about in earnest among Republicans. And it was, in fact, under Herbert Hoover that we had the first serious consideration of the Firearms Act. In 1928, there was a fellow by the name of Irwin Griswold, fresh out of Harvard Law School, not even 6 weeks. He goes directly into the U.S. Attorney's Office, works for the U.S. Solicitor General as Special Assistant. Who the heck is he? Well, it's a little unclear even to this day, but what he did do was he chaired a committee that was looking at national schemes for gun control. And what they were thinking of at the time was they wanted to control handguns. Handguns are easily portable, ne'er-do-wells and criminals, and these revolutionary types are always carrying handguns. And that's most of the type of gun violence that had happened about which these people were concerned back in that day. But there was a problem. There was the Second Amendment. You know, how do we ban or control or regulate handguns? And they studied this, and they put forward proposals, and they even attempted to introduce legislation all from 1928 through 1933. And it always ran out the Constitution. They couldn't do it. They tried to come up with ways. They tried to craft it in such a way it could skirt the law. But Irwin Griswold finally had a brilliant idea, an evil brilliant idea, the Congressional Authority for Taxation and Enforcement of Taxation has no limits. There's supposed to be limits, but in reality, in practical effect, no limits. If Congress decides they want to tax something, they can do almost anything to actually see it occur, and they can set the rates at almost anything. And so he said, well, how about, rather than trying to ban or register or whatever, any type of gun, we tax them. And then to enforce the tax, we can do whatever we want. And this is what became the National Firearms Act of 1934. They wanted to do it primarily for handguns. But popular sentiment at the time just went on. They took a gradual step. They targeted the evil guns of the day, these newfangled devices of the battlefield that had done so much slaughtering in the Great War, machine guns, short-barreled rifles, grenades, explosives, flamethrowers, that evil German weapon. And they called these the firearms that were going to be regulated under the National Firearms Act. But they weren't banning them. They were simply going to tax them. They declared, you have to pay a $200 tax, and of course to ensure that you've paid that $200 tax, and that you pay the tax every time one of these changes hands. Well, you have to get fingerprinted. We want the local law enforcement guys to check you out and report on whether you're one of these, you know, ne'er-do-wells we're so concerned about. And it was in this way that they essentially got registration, but on a class of weaponry that wasn't widely owned, wasn't widely sought, and so the public went for it because they figured, well, yeah, I mean, the only people who would really want machine guns are the ne'er-do-wells, the gangsters. And that was, you know, the famous Tommy gun of Prohibition that had been involved in the St. Valentine's Day Massacre, things like this. The Tommy gun actually had not been used in crime throughout gangsterism that much, a couple of high-profile incidents, but it was in the headlines, like assault rifles today. Sound familiar? And so they used Prohibition, which had already ended in 1933, to pass the National Firearms Act of 1934. So it was already kind of out of date, at least according to the reasons they sold the public at the time it went into effect. But they used that hype, the same sort of stuff you're seeing today. So there's parallels here. I'm just referring to my notes. So you have to understand, $200 in 1934, if you look at the price of silver, just as a guide, that's about, in today's money, $4,500. So can you imagine if under Feinstein's bill, they were to, at today's market, $800 tax, impose a tax of $4,500 every time you decide to go buy an AK-47. And if you decide after buying that AK-47, a couple years from now, I don't really want that, yeah, semi-auto AK-47, I don't really want it. I'm going to sell it off to somebody. Whoever you're going to sell it off to is also going to have to be willing to pay the $4,500. And that was part of the scheme back then to make it prohibitive. That, okay, even if there were legitimate people who wanted these weapons back in 1934, if there were, you know, good guys we can trust and they want them, okay, you know, if they can afford a $4,500 tax, well, then they must be well enough that they're not scum. You know, we'll let those people go ahead and own the good things, you know, if you're the elite. Well, the National Firearms Act of 1934, although they set a tax of $200, and it has not changed since 1934, there is nothing in the legislation pinning that amount. It can change any time Congress decides they don't want it to be. I mean, they could make it $5 if they want to. They could make it $50,000 if they want to. And I suspect one day that's going to occur. I'm kind of surprised it hasn't happened already. A lot of people are surprised it hasn't happened already. So you see here that this would be, and one more thing. In 1986, the National Firearms Act was modified. It was modified by something called the Gun Owners Protection Act of 1986, which was anything but. And what they did was they said, you know, we have these machine guns that people can own, and yeah, it's regulated, but do we really need so many machine guns? I mean, they're making more of them every year. Aren't there enough to go around? I mean, if you want to collect an old Nazi, you know, machine gun as a war trophy, well, they already exist. Why make new ones? And so under their taxation authority, Congress passed the law, and there's some argument about whether it actually got passed and actually made law, but it's being enforced, that you could no longer manufacture for civilian sales and consumption, and it capped the supply of machine guns currently in ownership and circulation as all that would ever be owned. And what this has done over time, since 1986, prices, market value prices, what the free market determines they're selling for, has risen steadily. It's beat out the advance of gold, it's beat out the stock market, it beats everything. Just as an example, an Uzi, prior to 1986, you could buy a semi-auto one, pay your $200 tax, go ahead and convert it in your garage, and for about $800, you had a full automatic Uzi machine gun. That same Uzi today sells for $8,000. Tenfold it has increased in a relatively short period of time. This has happened in a way that has attracted people to owning machine guns who aren't gun people. They're just investors. And those same investors now look at Dianne Feinstein and go, ooh, we cheaply buy common traded owned assault weapons today that next year will be under the NFA, and gee, they'll probably cap that supply too, don't you think? And then, with only so many in existence, the price will only go up. So this is actually a subset of people who aren't necessarily for gun control, but who are rooting for this because it will make them money, or so they think. Now, I don't mean to speak evil of profit motive, but I think you'll agree that's a little demented way to look at things. So this is where we're headed, or at least where Dianne Feinstein would like to take us. This is what has been proposed. And unfortunately, they have the precedent to do it. In 1996, I believe it was, 1994, the same year that the assault weapon ban was passed, it may have been Feinstein, I forget who introduced it, there was, it was not legislation, by the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms at the time. There was a class of shotgun out there called the street sweeper, essentially a rotary revolver-like shotgun with a big 12-round cylinder, and not as effective as it seemed. It's scary looking. It was kind of impressive to look at. It looked like it was right out of Star Wars, but just a shotgun essentially. But it just looked evil, and it skirted a lot of the assault rifle legislation that was being introduced at that time, because it did not actually operate by the same mechanism as so many of these other assault weapons. And so it escaped. It kind of got around some of that legislation. And some people were concerned about this. Well, someone gave the idea to ATF. You could just designate the street sweeper and other similar shotguns as a firearm that falls under the National Firearms Act. Just stroke of a pen, say it belongs under the act, and then regulate it like a machine gun. And they did exactly that, without a vote, without any coming from anybody in the government of an elected status. They just said, yeah, this really should be along with machine guns and everything else, so now it is. And if you have one, you're going to have like a pretty amnesty where you can turn this in, and if you're a qualified owner, we'll let you register it and all that, but in the future, if it gets sold or traded, $200 tax stamp, et cetera, et cetera. And there were people who were upset about that, but there weren't that many street sweepers in circulation, only a few thousand. There were only a few thousand owners who were kind of upset about this. So without a widespread hue and cry, nothing happened. And because nothing happened, the precedent has settled and it's considered established that the ATF, with the stroke of a pen, without Congress saying they need to, without the president supposedly saying they need to, could on their own say, you know what? Assault rifles, assault weapons, by their nature, really belong under the NFA. And so, yeah, that's what we're going to have to do. They could conceivably do that. But unlike in 1994 when they did it with the street sweeper, you're going to have a lot. But here's the unique opportunity. Feinstein does not actually need to pass her legislation. President Obama does not actually have to give an order, openly, admittedly, to the ATF. ATF can provide political cover to all those in government who are afraid of the consequences politically of gun control, and it can just be a functionary type of decision. Stroke of a pen, a bureaucrat says, yeah, these are all under the NFA now. The precedent exists. And because Feinstein has said that this is where we're going, because the president has promised that by late February we're going to have something, you have to wonder, is this their plan to have Washington within the span of 2 months for legislation this contentious to be able to promise people, yes, end of February, we got it. It's going to happen. What are they thinking? Now, I could be wrong about this, but this is where I see it going. This is where all the indications that I observe as a gun person who's been in this culture for a long time, who talks with a lot of people, this is what I see going on. This is how I think it's going to proceed. And I don't think the forces of evil who are proposing this really understand the potential consequences. Now, one of the consequences a lot of people are already talking about, you know, I was in a militia group, I was called a domestic terrorist, still considered that by the FBI and others, and I hung around with a lot of radicals in my day and still do, so I've heard a lot of talk about a lot of things throughout different years. And in the early 90s, after Waco and Ruby Ridge and all that was going on, there was a lot of people who were talking about militias, maybe we ought to join one, how are we ultimately going to resist the state when they come for our guns? There was a lot of talk in that age, not so much since then. Since this has been proposed, tenfold, but I was there. So I want you to understand that as part of this, you're also going to see an increase, whether real, imagined, discovered, or not, in militia activity. And this is going to spur the Justice Department and their people to start looking into that. And wouldn't it be handy if, in order to take everybody's attention off the crappy economy, we had domestic terrorism to chase in this country for the next 4 years? You know, let's say the ATF administratively rules, yeah, you got to register these assault weapons. You know, screw you, American gun owner, it's going to happen, comply or else. And some guys say, screw you, we're not going to comply. And we come to heads like that. Somebody gets stupid, somebody fires a shot, next thing you know, the militia is enemy, public enemy number one again. Everybody's hunting for the next Tim McVeigh again. And the economy is forgotten. Wouldn't that be handy for some people? I think that could as well be the plan. These are the things that are potentially not in the very far future. And they've happened in the past, yeah. So in a nutshell, that's it. And I'm not trying to scare you all, although I'm sure I have. but I just have to tell you that, you know, I am among these people who are most affected by this. I talk with them every day. I talk with them on the internet. I meet them in person. And a lot of it is talk. A lot of it is just talk. People are just talking right now, and let's hope that's all that ever happens. But these are very frustrated people. These are armed people, and they're people who take their rights seriously. And I am certain, I am confident, that if this legislation goes through, there will be blood. Maybe not a lot, maybe not right away, but there will be. So this is your wake-up call. If you weren't paying attention already, welcome to it.
He can stick around a couple minutes. Anybody got any questions for him?
Oh, I'm sorry, I did forget one thing. There is something I wanted to add. I brought a couple props.
Now, you have to understand, if semi-automatic assault weapons were brought under the NFA and were regulated just like machine guns, and if you decided you weren't going to comply and you were going to just keep your semi-auto AK-47 or AR-15 under the bed, you weren't going to tell anybody, well, getting caught with that would be the same as if you got caught with a machine gun. And I know what that's like. You know, you do 5 years as a minimum. Well, okay, then why would I want to be caught with just a semi-auto AK-47? Maybe I would want to turn that AK-47 into a true machine gun. I mean, what the hell? It's the same thing, right? This is one of the unintended consequences I don't think they've thought about. Or maybe they have. Maybe that's exactly what they want to happen, as somebody was saying to me earlier. So I want to show you something. Now this and this are two versions of the same item. One is completely unregulated.
Did it double-play?
I'm sorry. So these are two versions of the same object. This one is a completed and functional assault rifle, or at least the registered part of it. This is what's called a lower receiver. This is where most of the action takes place. It's the serial numbered part of a gun. And this is, you know, just this part all by itself would be regulated under the proposed new NFA rules. Whereas this is the raw metal forging that eventually gets turned into this. Now, you can buy these.
Dean, could you hold that up?
I'm sorry. I'll hold it up higher. How's that?
Put it up against the screen. Yeah.
All right. Can you see that?
That's a better thing.
Okay. And I'll pass this around. In fact, go ahead and pass it around. You can handle that. You can handle that, too, if you want.
It's just solid.
Yeah. So the point is, that forging right now, even a felon like myself can order that through the mail direct to my door, no regulation, no nothing. And there are versions of that that are mostly complete, you know, 50%, 80% complete, but not a complete firearm, still completely unregulated, able to own. There's nothing in the proposed legislation, and maybe nothing in the eventual bureaucratic signing that may take place, that says, you know, you can't order gun parts. As long as gun parts are available, there's going to be people who have some skill, not even a lot of skill, who will be able to just make their own. And this presents another problem. Currently under federal law, you're able to make, if you're a legal owner, you're able to make your own assault rifle, your own bolt action rifle, your own shotgun if you want to. You're not required to get a manufacturer's license as long as you're not selling them and making a profit and all that. And it's actually a big hobby for a lot of guys that since the 1994 assault weapon ban, when they could no longer readily buy them, they started making them. It's a whole cottage industry now. And as many things have gotten in short supply recently with this threatened legislation, you know, you can't find AR-15s anywhere for under $1,000 anymore. They've doubled, tripled in price, even just the kits to make your own gun, the tooling. Same thing, you can't even find it. But eventually, you know, that will all fix. There's nothing that stops somebody, even in the future, even under the most onerous legislation, from just making their own machine gun, since it would be the same penalty. And I foresee that if this legislation were to occur, you will see a lot more of that. You'll see a lot more people on Craigslist shopping around and saying, do you have a lathe? Do you have a mill? Do you have a CNC machine? I want to learn how to use one. Yeah. In fact, you know, along with some essential skills that I think everybody should learn, you know, myself, I want to learn how to weld, and I'm currently selling, you may want to learn machining processes. It might be a handy skill, you know. So these are the things that may come about. I'll take questions from anybody if you have them.
Question. Over there. Dean, you call unions communism. My question is, why is it...
Is this a gun thing?
Go ahead.
Why is it when the rich cats form unions of their companies and interest in money, it's called efficiency, but when the working man forms a union, it's called communism?
Right.
Yeah, in fact, Herbert Hoover himself, under whom these first initiatives began, was an advocate of the efficiency movement. He was referring to efficiency of government. He actually, despite being a Republican, was very progressive for the age. He actually believed in government fixing problems. And you got a point there, but you know what I was referring to was in broad strokes the big picture of how collectivism in general, under its various, you know, was a movement that was scaring a lot of moneyed people at the time. So, I mean, that's really another argument we could have for another time.
It's my understanding that Article 1 of the Constitution says Congress shall make the laws. Article 2 says the executive branch will put them into force, and that the president must enforce the laws. He doesn't get to pick and choose like he has been. It seems to me we got a bunch of treason going on. I don't see anything about going after these treasonous politicians and stuff, because they're coming in. I think I read someplace over 1,400 regulations, administrative side, where they're creating laws.
Yeah, we could talk about what the law is, and we could also talk about what the law is applied. Our current government really doesn't care about what the law is. They only care about the law they can apply.
But they're creating it. What I'm saying is,
I agree.
So you know where they live? Go get them.
I don't mean to shut down your argument. I understand what you're saying. For instance, I think it was Nancy Pelosi who was interviewed sometime in the last year, and somebody asked her regarding this program she was promoting. I forget what the program was, but some guy got in her face and asked her, well, what is the constitutional authority for that?
Yeah.
And she was absolutely stunned and befuddled and didn't know how to answer him and just said, are you serious? Yeah. And that, in a nutshell, is the entire government attitude about everything. So there's your answer.
Okay, now this is how Dean is known on the site. I just want everybody to know that. I got a call from somebody bitching about that. There's a woman, because she wanted to forward the article, but I'm not doing it if it's got this big. Hey, well, you know, that's Dean, man. He wants everybody to think you got a big brain.
Yeah, but as Ernie has said, you know, it gets your attention. You want to read the article.
Well, I want to look at the picture.
This is a three-part article. It's a very long, it takes up like 15 pages in the magazine. This was 2008, right after Obama got elected, and everybody got now 4 years later, and he wrote this article about, you know, kind of the stuff that he's talking about now, and also what guns to get, and how, why, laws, and so on. So it's a really good article.
Yeah. So, any other questions? Was there somebody else?
Yeah. We're talking about the downside in that and what they're going to do. Like, what is the consensus in the gunning group on counteracting this legislation, or
what do we do?
Well,
in
the end, ultimately, I think the only effective way to counter this is simple and massive noncompliance. You know, it's peaceful, and the key word being massive. I mean, if they tell you to do something and you just don't do it, well, then what? If they resort to violence because you don't do it, then you have every justification to go to whatever next step there is. And there's a lot of talk about that right now in gun guy circles. A lot of people are talking about that. An example of something like that recently on this continent was up in Canada. They had the infamous long gun registry that came about within the last 10 years. The idea being they were going to have, you know, this new world order up there, you know, a new wave of peace and prosperity. They were going to, you know, have every single rifle and shotgun in Canada registered, and they were going to know where the guns were, and they could round them up at any time, and this, that, and the other thing. And even the peace-loving and compliant Canadians said, screw you, we ain't going to do that. There was massive non-compliance, and it was just a 10-year boondoggle of millions and millions of dollars spent to no real effect, and it's now been dismantled. It doesn't mean the forces of evil up there have given up, they're going to try something else, but it shows you that if you just don't comply and you're locked in arms when you do it, it can work. And I'm hoping that that strategy will prevail, but of course in any group, there are hotheads, and our enemies on this issue require need and desire, and will seek out the hotheads and maybe promote them. So you need to look out for that.
Dean, what's your solution to try to reduce the mass murders and slaughters like we've recently had?
More guns.
I believe in personal responsibility, and if you are willing to leave the responsibility of your children up to strangers, then leave them with strangers you think can defend them. If you're willing to leave them in an unarmed place, that's on you. I don't have children myself, but if I did, there would be no way I would leave them at a school that did not have armed personnel. I don't think there's a one-size-fits-all, but it is true, as Wayne LaPierre said, not that I'm a fan of his, that the only thing that stops a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun. There have been ideas floated about, oh, we should arm teachers and we should do this and that. All you have to do is simply allow the teachers who wish to be armed and who show a competency in doing so, let them do that. In gun circles, we call people like that sheepdogs. They're those who walk among us who take on the responsibility of being the sheepdog, protecting the rest of the sheep from the wolves. There are plenty of sheepdogs throughout our society at all levels, many of them teachers. Many of them would be happy to protect your children with their own life if they have to. Some did at Sandy Hook, but they just weren't armed. So all you have to do is let them do what they're willing to do. Maybe have a testing procedure or something, but it's a simple solution, but the problem is, in fact, Pelosi suggested, let's put the National Guard in the schools. She introduced a bill that would allow the state governors to take National Guard troops and post them at schools, armed National Guards people. But if guns are the problem, if you don't want guns in schools, as they're saying, why would you put a guy with a gun in the school? Well, he's a government guy with a gun in the school.
It's even worse.
So first, I want to thank you for all your work. But I was curious, in your gun circles from your community, are there any congressmen that you believe would really spend political capital on our side for this, not just talk?
No. It is an uncomfortable position for even some of the most diehard freedom lovers to be in, because even when you know you're right, when everybody standing around you is pointing the dirty finger at you and saying, you scum, you know, we're human, we react to that. And And Congress is one big high school peer pressure group. I kind of trust Rand Paul, maybe, Justin Amash and some of those guys, but I mean, is there anyone from the Arizona contingent I trust? Hell no. You know, the one positive thing I can say, and I'm probably going to be meeting with the guy next weekend, you know, as part of my duties infiltrating the Republican Party, and we're having our party meetings here this month, the state convention, the county convention, there is a guy running for state party chair who is a true dyed-in-the-wool gun guy. He has a gun instruction school. He is Second Amendment through and through. Now, I don't know how else he is on other liberty topics. I need to talk with him and find out. But that's a guy who, at least at the party level here in this state, I would trust to ramrod our state legislatures and keep them in line. So,
what's his
name?
I have to look it up. I have it written down. I just learned about him last night.
Doug Little.
Yes, David Little. That's him.
Doug Little.
Yeah, he's out of Legislative District 23 over in Scottsdale.
Just on that note, there's an article that Doug Little wrote for the Arizona Political Times or whatever it is, mm-hmm. where he accuses the Ron Paul people of trying to overtake the AZGOP nominating convention back in May. He's not a liberty guy. He might be a gun guy, but he's not a liberty guy.
He did write that article, but I do know that some liberty people will be with him this weekend discussing all of that.
And I hope to talk with him myself.
He wasn't totally informed, and supposedly he's changing his colors. We'll see, but I do know that there are a bunch of liberty-minded people like ourselves who will be sitting down with him.
As it is, I have a close friend who is close friends with him, and I didn't know this until I discovered that they both went to the original shooting academy up in northern Arizona, and they teach classes together, and apparently they sometimes have these deep philosophical discussions, and so this friend that we have in common, I've talked with him and said, hey, tell me about Doug Little. I mean, what do I need to know? And you know, maybe you can talk with them. And, you know, we got to work every angle we can. But you know, I don't claim to have a whole lot of solutions, but I can tell you what I see coming.
Well, there's a movement now over disarming the police and a little response to Pat's statement. You know what the single number one group for killing people with guns is in the United States? Cops kill almost 10% of all the people killed by guns. Mm-hmm. If you took guns away from cops, that's 1,000 people a year.
And an even stronger argument can be made that by ending the drug war, you end so many deadly confrontations that result in this sort of thing. So, yeah, you know, despite the fact I'm currently in the Republican Party, don't be confused. I'm a libertarian through and through. So, you know.
Is there anyone in the state legislature or any possibility of the state legislature to stand up for Arizona's sovereignty on this issue or other issues?
You know, I didn't like him on many other matters, but unfortunately, Frank Antonori of Southern Arizona got voted out. But he was a neocon, but he was for Arizona sovereignty. Who now, like him, takes it that seriously? I don't know. But again, you know, part of my involvement in the state convention, the county convention of the Republican Party, I'm going to rub elbows with all these people, talk to a bunch, and hopefully the next time we meet, I can have better answers.
Where does the United Nations Treaty on Handgun Control fit in on all this?
Yeah, that's a very good question, and nobody seems to have a definitive answer because, of course, there are those who say that, well, you know, there can be no treaties that the United States is party to that are in contravention of our Constitution. And there are others who say, well, no, you know, the Constitution says that if you sign a treaty, it becomes supreme law of the land. And so which is it? Is it possible that we could sign a treaty and have it held enforceable against us that violates our Second Amendment? It's one of those things that I'm sure they're saying right now, we have to vote it to see what's in it. My opinion is, you know, if they're even talking about it, they're dirty, filthy scum, and they deserve to be dragged out in the street like a dirty dog. But and that, more than anything else, would really spur the militia movement. And they've done that for decades. That would be the last thing they'd want to do, because you would have universal noncompliance at that point, pretty much.
I was listening, by the way, to Alex Jones and Larry Pratt this morning, and that treaty is coming up in March of this year. We're only 2 months away from that treaty.
Go ahead, back there.
What I was going to talk about, so on that treaty, is they're supposedly signing that under the Treaty of Versailles, Versailles,
mm-hmm.
All right? In which case, then, only the Secretary of State could sign it, And then, of course, if it was a president or a king or a dictator in some other country, they also would have to sign it, which Obama is. However, they have, if he doesn't bring it up in front of Congress or whatever, within 12 months, it's supposedly the law. Now, with the Senate, like it is, if he brings it up, they're going to go for it anyway. But if he does nothing, it automatically goes into law.
Well, without trying to search, really the best way to answer it is to say that at the heart of your question is philosophy. And that is, the best way to sum it up is, you know, you've all heard the saying, we are a nation of laws, not men. That's bullshit. I mean, I know there's attorneys in the room who may disagree with me on this, but my experience with the law has been that what the law is or says means absolutely nothing without the men who interpret it, enforce it, apply it. So we are, in fact, a nation of men pretending to be a nation of laws. So what the law says, what it may actually be, in fact, bears almost no fact to what's going to happen, what's going to be applied. This is where it really does matter, the character of the people that are in government. If you don't have people in government of character, it doesn't matter what the law says. So I know that doesn't actually answer what you asked, but I think, in fact, it does. Anything else? Okay.
Thank you. This is mine. I let Dean use it as a demonstration purposes.
That's why you can throw it on the ground.
Yeah, come on. This is what I wanted to do is kind of give you a history so you can understand what I anticipate is coming. Okay. Some of you guys may be able to, you know, interject here. I don't want to get off on the other crap. I want to focus on this issue. That means Pat is just going to have to hold it, man. So this is, you know, how I experienced it as a young man becoming, you know, I grew up, my father had guns. I mean, I was a kid in Florida. We went out shooting, and I remember my first rounds through a firearm. My father giving me it was like a $9.99, $10 gun from Montgomery Ward's back in the early 1900s that was given to my father. His dad came to me, and I refinished the stock and everything with my son, gave it to him. So, I mean, you know, this is, you know, a 100-something-year-old piece of crap, single-shot, 22 for $10 from Montgomery Ward's, okay? So, I mean, I grew up knowing how to use firearms. My dad was a quick draw artist. He, every Labor Day, when I was a kid, the JCs had, you know, he'd be the sheriff, you know, what, drunk, and had the, you know, the street and the parade and the can-can girls going around. And boom! I mean, my dad was amazing, how fast. You ever see Magnificent Seven where a guy goes like this, clap your hands?
Yeah.
My dad could do that. But I have guys from high school come over and said, I go, all right, you want to see it, make sure, check the gun, make sure, you know, do all that kind of stuff. Boom, the gun's in. It's like, wow. Mess with the Hancock kid. Okay? So I kind of grew up in this kind of culture. Guns was just a tool, it was just a thing. It was be safe, don't be stupid. And I remember the first time, and my dad's still alive. I'll say bad things later. But anyway, the thing is, he's kind of a jerk, okay? I'm going like this, and I, you know, did something unsafe. I just did, all of a sudden, boom, I kind of like come to on the ground. You know, he's waiting for me to do something unsafe, so and he goes like, bam! I won't do that anymore. That's how we got trained, okay? So this is, I had gun safety in my mind, and when I got married, Donna and I got married in 84, right?
You will learn that answer tonight.
Then a month or two after that, we're going out. My father would, try and teach your wife to bargain. Hell no. So I had my father take her out and so on. We went camping. Whenever we go camping, I would go to my father and I was going to be in an unsafe situation. I was going to be somewhere. I just go to my dad's and I'll pick that one. Okay? So it was never like I felt I was disarmed. I never had it with me or so on until we started SAFE. Second Amendment is for everyone. I am the founder, director, creator, blah, 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 getting all this attention internationally. You want to come see the militia man, Ernie Hancock, and he doesn't own a gun. When we would go to things and activists, because I was poor, they're like money. If I need one, I'll go get one from my dad. So what happened was, we would be going to different protests and everything. There was one guy, you guys may remember, okay? He was so pissed off that I'd be at all this stuff and speak and didn't have a gun, he gave me a Makarov, okay? Here, have a gun. I called this a gun. Anyway, so I, at the time, they were selling Makarovs, which is a Russian, or they had Czechoslovakian, all kind of different ones. They're little Russian policeman, flat holster, 9mm. But they're not the Luger 9mm. They're like a millimeter shorter, not as powerful. But they're very reliable. I like the way they work. They're kind of heavy. But it's a gun, okay? Then you go buy some hot ammunition called mag safes, and then it's like a real gun. So we're going, okay, so I got a gun. SKSs were being imported by the freaking sea container full, and you could buy 5 at a time, all packed up and so on from Russia or whatever, 5 at a time for $69 a piece. So you were getting, you know, for what's on stock, you got 5 guns. So back then, I know people that were buying a whole bunch of SKSs, which is, you know, uses the same rounds as the AK-47. It's what Vietnamese or their strap bandolier kind of going out and kicking U.S. military's butt in Vietnam kind of stuff with. So we had the SKSs, the Makarovs, and then, you know, a shotgun or something like that. I mean, you know, for a couple of $100, a few $100, you're armed up. When they did the assault, when they did the Brady Bill, when that happened, man, everybody got armed up. I had no guns. I have a couple of guns now, okay? I didn't feel the need for it, but I understood the reasoning behind it. Where SAFE came from, we did a newspaper. It's kind of like a precursor. It's kind of an evolution, you know, goes back to Freedom's Phoenix. The newspaper was called Citizens Taking Initiative. And what we were doing is we were going, all right, if we were legislators, what kind of stuff would we introduce? Well, a lot of these became bills. They became law. The legislators go, hey, somebody already did it, it's popular, and I didn't even have to write it, and it's cool, and I put my name on that, boom, and it becomes law. How'd that happen? Okay? So it got to the point where they started having the front page of the Valiant State, the B section, Arizona Republic, second legislature convenes. So what they were doing is they made sure that we knew, that people knew that we were the ones that were kind of behind the scenes kind of pushing stuff as opposed to the Arizona Republic. The Arizona Republic would go up and say, this is how we're going to determine who are good and bad legislators and endorsements and everything, and whoever's going to pass our thing on environmentalism one year, or it would be on mental health, or another year it would be on whatever the heck it was. All of a sudden, nobody's paying attention to them. They're looking at all the initiatives that we're filing in the tens of thousands of newspapers that we're slinging all over the state. In fact, that's how I knew Big John over there. He would come down to my little Roach Motel apartment that's 2-bedroom, 1-bath with 4 kids and 2 dogs, you know, and this little $400 a month thing we lived for 9.5 years as we did all this activism. He would come by and I'd give him a bunch of newspapers and he'd go put them in libraries all over the state. He'd travel around, you know, doing that kind of stuff. Well, it just permeated throughout the state. Well, I get called by the Arizona Republic Editorial Board, and they bring me in. I remember when this was. It was December of 93. They brought me and Rick Tompkins. I was an independent at the time. Rick Tompkins, state chair of the Libertarian Party. They sat me down. They had like a dozen editors, a lot of guys you know, and they said, what do you want? I don't know what I want. Why you called me? What do you want? You know? What did the... They were the ones that were going to determine what, and we were mucking up their plans. So if we would agree to focus on any one thing or something, they would give us attention, and we'll lay hands on, and we'll do a story, and we'll cover, and whatever, and they'll buy us off with vanity. No. Vanity, my favorite sin. See my point? So I'm going, you guys have no idea what's coming. You can't even comprehend what's coming. You don't get it. You know, and then Rick Tompkins piped in. He goes, well, what Ernie's trying to say, and I knew he was trying to make nice. And I go, no. What I'm trying to say is you guys don't matter. Now, of course, then they had every evidence that they did. But I knew we had just got our first emails, and a lot of things were happening I'll tell you about, that I'm going, oh, I get it. They are the gatekeepers. They're a filter. They're a sieve. They're the ones that we, and even Paul Schacht was editorial page editor of the Arizona Republic. And the Arizona Breakfast Club used to meet, one of the times, used to meet at the Elks Club up North Cape. You guys remember that, some of you guys? I mean, you'd have a couple hundred people there. I mean, before the internet really got going, you'd go to the Breakfast Club, you didn't know what the hell was going on, okay? So Paul Schacht was there, and he gets up and he does blah, 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 blah. And I get up and I ask a question. I go, how many months, just to be a jerk, how many months, this is in the 90s, is going to go by before the internet replaces printed newspapers? Just kidding. But I saw it was coming. This is what he said. He goes, you need a conservative paper like the Arizona Republic and a conservative editorial page editor like me to tell you what you need to know. Oh. Tape, please! He said it. And I'm like, if that doesn't tell you everything you need to know right there. One of the things that we had done is we took and we printed out a paper. Let me borrow this for a second. We had a, you get petitions that are 8.5 by 14, right? The law is that the petition has to have attached to each petition the actual verbiage of whatever is on it. So what we did is we had it printed up. They looked like this, and it had a perforation right here. And one side had the entire initiative, because it was a constitutional, always did real short stuff. We changed this, says this, you can't do this, always that. So we put it on the back side, you had the petition notary stuff you had to do on the back of the petition, and on the back here was an instruction on how to use it, where to mail it, how to do it. You remember those? So what we did is we did 80,000 of them, 20,000 for each of four initiatives. One of them was the unrestricted concealed carry. When we did that, we had to create a PAC, a political action committee, to be able to run the, blah, 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 you file Secretary of State and do the committee of, we're going to name it, what are we going to name it? Shooter's World, which was like the bastion of all kinds of all that is evil. Shooter's World at the time was owned by, I think it was called the Pegasus Group.
Pence's
Group was a developer here in the Valley, and they wanted to buy Ben Avery. Well, they couldn't just get it, So we're going to take and turn it over to the county, is going to run as a park, and we're going to do whatever, and then it's going to be ours, okay? Because they bought Cowtown, which is like a movie studio thing. They played paintball up by Lake Pleasant. They wanted the marina, they did at Lake Pleasant. This is the development company that was using, Shooter's World was just kind of their infiltration into Second Amendment. We got a crowd to do what the hell we want. And what they were wanting to do, Ben Avery himself, they had a meeting to where they were going to take Ben Avery and talk about turning it over, because what they had done is a land lease. You can go to Bureau of Land Management and say, I want to, have a remote control airplane thing here. I want to do a cattle whatever leasing. I want to ride horses. I want to do an ultralight land here. I want to do, fine, whatever. Well, one of those things that they did, we're going to do a shooting range. And it kept developing and developing and developing. It was all private. Well, they said, if you turn it over to us, Maricopa County, Parks and Rec, well, then we'll pave this and put shaded whatever, and we'll, just get us. Behind the scenes, we knew what they were really doing. It was a land grab, because the Valley was starting to move up to Ben Avery's prime real estate, Carefree Highway right there. So then you started hearing, oh, the lead in the ground, poor children, going out there licking the desert and on a shooting range. Okay? You think I'm kidding? Right? So then I'm going, right. So here comes the lobbyists and the shiny tie guys, and they're making the offer and doing it. We had a meeting, it was like this, and I'm back there, I'm county chairman of the Libertarian Party kind of deal. Ben is doing his thing, we're going to, they promise, and we got a thing, and I go, and I get up and I said, look, I don't want, but I want to tell you guys what you don't know. See that guy right there? That guy right there? They're talking. they're doing this, 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 and this, FYI, go peace. Ben goes, meeting's freaking over, okay? He went and found out that everything I said was true. Up to that. All of a sudden, then it became a big gun political issue, and they started to realize what was really going on, and it eventually became under Arizona Game and Fish, as it is now.
Yeah.
But there was a whole bunch of other stuff in between there, how this happened. One of the things, when I first started doing radio, I think it was like I was on for maybe a year, 2004, Phoenix has this thing called Phoenix Points of Pride, okay? Big campaign, the CEO, whatever, of Southwest Airlines is the chairman, they got all these people, of course you know it's going to be the Phoenix Zoo, it's going to be the Heritage Museum, it's going to be, you know, whatever the heck Phoenix has that, you know, they can be proud of. Well, I go, oh, Ben Avery's in the city limits of Phoenix. And we proud, okay? So I called Southwest Airlines guy, and I called the paper, and I called the committee, and I called, you know, all this so-and-so, you know, declaring independence on KF, and blah, 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 blah. And I go, I know what the criteria is. How do you determine a point of pride for Phoenix? Well, there'll be some public input, you know. We'll consider, you know, if we get, you know, like 400,000 postcards or something. But otherwise, we're going to do what the heck we want, okay? So I thought. So I went, he had to fill out a form thing, and there was a guy, a range master guy that was running, you know, he worked for the government or whatever, that was doing Ben Avery. And I said, look, if you fill out the paper, you know, kind of the nomination thing for this, you know, I'll go on my shoulder, you know, just, you know, makes a big deal out. Of course, Ben Avery was number one. I mean, it's more than all the others combined. We love Ben Avery. They didn't want to do it, though. Begrudgingly, they came out without really a choice, and they go, Ben Avery is one of Phoenix Points of Pride. And then I knew for a little while, okay? Because what was Phoenix City doing at the time? Phoenix City, we, at the time, they wanted to get rid of guns in the worst way. So what they did is, there was a gentleman you may have met, thanks Dean, thank you Dean. Don't be suckered in by their bullshit either. Because it'd be coming, I guarantee it. The city of Phoenix had signs on their parks that would say, firearms prohibited, city ordinance, blah, blah, blah. Well, if you read the ordinance, it didn't really say that. Steve Porak is a contractor that built churches here in the valley, and I think he's retired now. But at the time, he had a Cortez Park over on like Dunlap and 35th or something like that. He had his little grandchildren, he was there visiting them, he took them to the park. I think it's a 1911 he has on. So he has cowboy hat, and he's a Marine, and he's, you know, gray-haired older guy and got his gun on, and everybody's safe around where I am. We're all good. It's kind of getting kind of hoody down there, you know, a little bit. You got the minorities kind of, you know, their, you know, top button done and everything else done. They're kind of walking around flashing their 38 a little bit as their, you know, it'd be our park, okay? So that's why he's armed. So he goes there, he has his kids play, and a police officer sees him, comes up, he's there in the park, in the parking lot, goes up to him, you can't have that gun here, ordinance, day law, whatever, you gotta be disarmed and doomed, whatever, and put it in your car. And oh, he didn't like that. Goes and he puts it in his car, the police officer leaves, it starts getting dark, he's playing with his kids, he's getting ready to go, all of a sudden, here comes a bunch of the gang members to go play basketball, and he sees half of them armed. Where's the cop now? So he made a big deal. He's a political guy. He's a precinct guy. So he starts talking to legislators that he knows. He goes to the city council. You're my city councilman. This is how Constitution, this is how it's supposed to work. And I'm a constituent, and I'm here complaining, and I'm a young, blah, 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 blah. And they're like, that sucks to be you. That is done by Parks and Rec. They make that sign. And you got to deal with him. He comes and tells me the story. I'm Maricopa County chairman. We have our headquarters downtown. He comes up, and he's a Republican, Symington guy, but he's starting to become more and more libertarian. So he talks to me. We got to know each other. And I go, that's not what the law says. Did you even read it? What the law says, it says no discharge of firearms in a public park.
Oh.
It didn't say no possession. Ooh. They didn't want you out there just, you know, plinking around. Okay? So it's no discharge. You know, except in defense of, you know, somebody's trying to, you know, kill me, I'm allowed to, like, keep breathing. So I go, that's not what it says. Well, they won't change it. They won't do it. It's kind of this administrative we can get away with thing. Parks and Rec had a bunch of socialist, communist, istis, whatever the hell, that they didn't like guns, okay? So they were like, man, we ain't we put that on that sign, it says that, and we're done. Okay, here we go. Here comes SAFE. When we were in Shooters World offices and we were first creating and doing the concealed carry, they already had a plan in their head of how they were going to use us. We didn't know it at the time. But we're talking, and somebody came up, there was an organization for something else called FADE or SAFE, something like SAFE out of California on some other issue. And somebody just blurted it out, SAFE, Second Amendment for everyone. I'm like, boom, done. Safe gun owner, unsafe gun owner, unsafe legislator, love it, okay? So we went ahead and made some hats, got, you know, whatever. That puts you on a list. I don't know how you get on this list, but it was definitely a list. Southern Poverty Law Center did a list that went out to all law enforcement and county. It said, oh, here are the militias, okay? Well, who's at the freaking top of this national list? Arizona A, the first one that has any kind of gun, they put me on the list, SAFE. Ernest Hancock, here's their address and phone number. We had German film crews, Japanese film crews, South Korean magazines. We had the Miami Herald, and the Boston blah, 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 and yada, yada, yada. I mean, just, I mean, everybody, I'm like, whoa, man, I knew I was good looking, you know? What the hell? Right then, I'm saying, I can't remember if it was before or after, I get a call from Sheriff Arpaio, okay? Now, I've known Arpaio since 92. I was on his weekly Rolodex, man. And he'd call and heard, ooh, gotta get, you know, me and Arpaio. Why? Because I had lawsuits against the state of Arizona on election law to represent, I was Republican, but I went independent to get standing because I knew what they were doing. I saw happen to Dr. Paul. I knew how they worked this. You know, the election laws aren't there for you to have a voice. It's for you to not have a voice, okay? So I'm going, okay. So what I did is I filed all these suits. There is no representation of independents, but they made up 14% of the registered voters at the time, but they were 29% of the people that actually voted in the general election. So even though that may not get them elected in the primary, without the independent vote, you don't get to be anything, certainly at that time. So that's why I'm on Evan Meekum. He was running for U.S. Senate at the time. After he'd been impeached as governor, he got found not guilty, he's running for Senate again. He and his son come visiting me in my Roach Motel, okay? So at this time, I'm a popular guy. Everybody and their grandma wants to be my buddy. Why? Because they think I represent and I control all the independents that are independent. I'm like, they obviously don't get it. They don't even understand it. So I've known Joe, we've had conversation over the years. He's kind of slowing down now. They insulate him a little bit more. They don't want him to go play in the sandbox with anybody without adult supervision, you know what I mean? So, they, you know, so it's a little more difficult. I might have to go visit him or something. But, because I had a call into him this last week and to the Phoenix Police Department. Neither of them had called me back, but usually they call me right back. So I go, maybe it's holidays, you know, I'll wait a week or two and then I'll call them. But if they're not calling me back, oh, something be a coming, okay? Arpaio calls me and at the Libertarian Hangar, he goes, Ernie, oh, you're on the list. I go, looks like I made it. So I'm going, cool, right on, man. Thanks, Joe. Peace. Okay? I didn't care. You know, because I knew that I was going to be the calm, cool, collected, no compromising message I would like to get out. So and that's, you know, why I was chair. So I'm going, okay, so we did the spiel, I do the interviews, I had New York Times come to my rest, they had a picture of me with my gun on and my, you know, on and different issues, and then, you know, I always do, you know, the same we get to defend against and all that kind of stuff. So I'm the kind of guy they don't like, and if you guys go to CNN, Ernest Hancock, and you see that interview, that is all in a nutshell exactly why. Because damn it, it's a Larry Crabb, Piers Morgan thing. They don't like that. They don't want to be logic and they want to get the guy, if you'll have 300 people at an event, and where do the cameras go? The guy wearing the floppy camo hat, wearing the whatever.
Yeah.
That's the guy, okay? So I'm going, okay. At the time, the Southern Poverty Law Center was trying to get, they're really work hand in glove with enforcement as their excuse to infiltrate these different groups. This is why. So movement after COINTELPRO, FBI, they were in all these different groups, which they keep going, by the way, you don't ever think they stop. They're in these different groups gathering information, they're going to go prosecute them for whatever. Well, the Klan Watch guys and, you know, Southern Poverty Law Center and all that kind of stuff, they were like, well, look, if you can't investigate these evil racist, white supremacist, black-hating, minority, racial, whatever the heck, if you can't, well, we're going to investigate them for you, and then we give you the reports. Well, this is where the MIAC reports come from, and, you know, if you got a Ron Paul bumper sticker, you are, should be pulled over and questioned.
That's right.
You guys remember that?
No,
yeah. That's where that came from, was from some of the other crap, okay? So they were targeting SAFE. Well, I didn't care. I'm like, you know, you're confusing if someone gives a crap what you think anyway. Well, just this last year, I had Mark Potok, which is the editor of the, what do they call it, intelligence report or something, the Southern Poverty Law Center. Now, before, Heidi Byrick, the director of special projects for the Southern Poverty Law Center, was coming to Arizona, all kinds of media, trying to, you know, go find the, you know, three or four black people in Phoenix, put them on TV, and say, look, we got racial war coming, skinhead, something. And it was, they're always trying to twist it into a racial thing because that was their beginning. If it can't be a racial thing, then it's not really making any sense. So they would come in at the, you know, they would say they were invited by the city of Phoenix, but then they would kind of offer their services and come and do a whatever, and the TV cameras are there. And they'd have from 10 years ago when some black guy got a thing, a threatening whatever the heck. I mean, they were really scraping, you know, come up with some kind of visual or story that they could tell. While we had a workshop and doing our television and video studio and everything, jumped down to film this thing and interviewed her and talked to her and had a good time and became friends on Facebook and all this other stuff, right? Know her birthday, get her stuff, yeah, we party and we drink like fish and yada, yada, yada. Oh, by the way, we want all your guns. So this is in a relationship. And they convince her to come on my radio show. She's been on my radio show 3 times, okay? Well, that kind of opened it up. Mark Potok, he's like, hey, how come you get all the fun? I want to go on Declare Your Independence, and I want to be on, and I want to come. And I'm like, okay. So he comes on, and I have a couple of questions. Heidi and I get along fine. I understand. She's there. She's making her money. She's got her job. She's there to do whatever, so we kind of have fun about it. But this is what was going on. They were listing as patriots on there guys like Ron Paul, Judge Napolitano, Sheriff Richard Mack, Gary Franchi from Restore the Republic. They had the owner of one of the networks I was on, I can't remember his name now, but the owner of one of the networks I was on, they had a bunch of guys, you know, Stuart Rhodes from Oath Keepers. I mean, it's just a big, long list, you know, and I've had half these guys at the Freedom Summit. I'm friends with, you know, most of them. You know, we worked together, we're co-chairs of the co-MCs at the Revolution March in Washington, me and Gary. I had, you know, blah, blah, I'm the Revolution guy, Lovolution. I, you know, I had Second Amendment for everyone. I've been on there, I go, what the hell I got to do to get on your list? I'm like, seriously, how come I'm not on there? That's what they told me. We didn't want to put you on, Ernie, because we knew you wanted to be. In another interview I picked up, they said, well, we don't put libertarians on the list. Really? Why? Well, it's a legitimate philosophy. Okay, what determines legitimate philosophy? Because we're wanting to do with the way with the, I'm wondering what your deal is. And I go, how is it as a racist thing that you're making this? How is it we're racist, you know, by being against the government? I don't get how that's a racial thing. Because our president is black, and if you're against the government, you're a racist. This is actually what they're saying. So after a few interviews with her, she's scheduled for a Thursday of 1 week, and Mark Potok is scheduled that Monday. Immediately after the interview I get done with Mark, she calls, it wouldn't be prudent at this juncture for me to come on, so she cancels, and I haven't talked to him since. Mark Potok gets up, and I go, look, I just really got one. He tells me his history, and we go, and I just kind of, like, I really got one question. And it's everything I can do to keep him on. During the break, yeah, we're going to break. And I go, yeah, okay, now what do you want to say? Help me all be buddies and anything. And I keep that recording, and I put it out in the archive, our conversation between, during commercial breaks, too. That's good, okay? So this dude, Mark Potok, you know, Nurse Tam, I'll send her Nurse Tam, you listen to the show, get it. So my main question was this. What is the criteria that you use to determine a group is bad? How do you do that? What's the criteria for that? And if you take that same criteria, you know, death, violence, bad, whatever, and you move it over to the government and look at them, how are they not worse? I mean, it's death, dying, destruction, droning, taking, doing, stealing. Well, I mean, you know, where's your beam now? I mean, how is it that, and when cops do bad, there's always some dudes in government doing bad stuff. Well, so it just made them look stupid. It hit Daily Paul, and they posted it and said, oh, Ernie Go kicks crap on Southern Poverty Law Center, and it just went postal, and they're done, okay? So that's why I wanted to do this stuff, is because the Levolution, I only needed to hear it once. How do they know if somebody's good or bad? Well, Ernie interviews them, that's how. In the early 90s, we do this guns for the walk in the park thing. We said, look, the law is not that we have to be disarmed in the park. You're just making that up as you go along. So we took Bob's A.B. Dick 360 printing press, you know, one of the first things that we did flyers by the thousands. We put them at the gun ranges, we went to the gun stores, and we went everywhere. And by then, they're starting to be a little bit nicer to us, because in 94, when we did the initiative, nobody would touch it. Any retail gun store would not put it in their shop. They knew the BATF be all over their ass. They're like, hell no, we don't have that. You're never going to get concealed carry. And without a permit or anything in Arizona, that's just not going to, it never is. And I go, look, I'm young, and I, you know, never ever, it's a long time for me, man, you know? So we're thinking decades in the future. I had already got, you know, clearance from my wife for 10 years. I got to be as big a butthead as I want. Okay? And in 2000, I had to, you know, renew the, she said, yeah, go ahead. What we did is we took those flyers, put them everywhere, and we're saying, we're going to take your gun for a walk in the park, you know, this Saturday in a couple of weeks. Oh, hell no, because we were going to challenge, there's, arrest me, some bitch. Under what? Well, it says, I go, well, we know that's bullshit. Go ahead. Okay? So they were like, oh, little cursing Red Baron, okay? So they have a meeting. It's 2 days before. It's like Thursday before the Saturday we're going to be. And they know it's going to be a thing. The media's all over it. They can't wait. Now, of course, they're going to say, oh, my God, white people with guns. But, you know, it's just, you know, yeah, we didn't care. So here comes the, we had the Sheriff's Department. We had the Phoenix Police Department. You guys, some of you may remember Jean McGrath, who's a legislator, Republican. She was a good gunny at the time. She came to the meeting, and some other, I think the county attorney's office came. And they're going to go, oh, well, we need to work out. There's nothing to work out. And they go, Ernie, we fixed it. It's all good. Don't worry about it. What they had done is they took, and it said, no firearms in the park, blah, 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 and it had the ordinance. They took white permanent tape, and they put it over the ordinance. Well, now it's legal. It doesn't reference the ordinance. And I go,
really?
Right. Okay. Well, I think we're going to go anyway. Okay. And I had Donna, I called her at home, and I said, run to the park next to our house, give me a call back, and let me know if, in fact, all the parks, we were up in the middle of the North Mountain Park, I mean, they had really, you know, send all the boys out to do this, you know, get this done in a day. And she goes, yep, they got tape over it. So I'm going, wow, that is so slimy. You know, it doesn't mean anything. So then I go, all right, we're going to be doing it. We'll be there Saturday and get over it. Now, Dean, at the time, their Viper team guys, they would go different, and we had these kind of things, they would do patrol. That was their role. They would go around, nobody asked them, they just did it. They knew there was going to be, you know, surveillance, and the guys with the cameras, and they're taking license plates, and taking pictures of people, and they're doing whatever. Well, they were kind of outside of them, just kind of there. They were outside of them, you know, kind of keep an eye on stuff, okay? They didn't like that either. That's one reason why they wanted to get them, okay? So what happened was, it's Saturday, there's like 70 of us go down there, and we've all got little kids and dogs and frisbees, and everybody's got a gun. Guitars are playing, just, and then all of a sudden, here comes all the media. Well, the police are kind of around on the walk, you're, you know, 100 yards away or something. But what are you doing? Well, what are you doing here? They're right over there, they got a gun! Go get them! And they do with the law. They go, hey, we're just here to protect our rights and keep peace and all that kind of stuff. And they're like, what? Keep in mind, Waco, Ruby Ridge, assault weapon ban days. I mean, it was banned. They want to get them something on somebody, okay? So then they go over and they see a family. There was a black family that was having a family reunion about 200 yards away across in Cattle Park. This was white people with their guns. What do you have to say about that? Okay? So that goes on, you know, but then they show it. So it just didn't really work out the way they wanted. At the same time, 1994, we are deciding we're going to get involved. You know, Judge Buttrick, you know, runs for governor. I run for Secretary of State. We had a full slate. We're kicking ass. All of a sudden, libertarians just popped up on the scene in 94. What the hell just happened? Well, we needed a headquarters. We were going to raise money. How do we do that? Well, we're going to raise some money now. So what did we do? We did this for months and raised the money. But at the end, on the drawing day, we took a 4x8 sheet of plywood, so nothing, and wired up an AR-15, a MAC-90, and an SKS, okay? We were raising $5 a ticket, and it said the Liberty Rifle Raffle. So, the NRA, they're raffling off a lever action and a six gun. They don't want to be too politically incorrect. But we understood the whole point. A pistol grip, detachable, magazine, black, ugly gun. So when you spoke like this at a SAFE function, I got pictures that, you know, Sheriff Mack, Jim Sharp from KFYI, you have, he's been good for a long time, I have a bunch of other politicians and so on. Everybody, you want to speak to the SAFE thing? You must first pick from the table and say, I want the AR, the FAL, the AK, you pick one or two, some guys did too. They would take it and they go, color photograph with that gun before you could talk. Now you say, how good one do we have in Arizona? I knew Trent Franks from church back in the day. This is what he did. He showed up at one of our events. I think it was at the Crescent Hotel or the Holiday Inn over there on off of 17. We're having a big SAFE thing. Something was going on, and everybody's doing their spiel. Trent Franks showed up. It's election year. He's got to be seeing his Second Amendment. And he goes, I'm going to hold up this gun. He didn't want to have his picture taken with a detachable magazine, black. And, you know, I'm going, well, then, you know, you can't speak, and I'm not talking to you, and, you know, have a nice day. Oh, no, but look at this. And it looked like a 20-gauge shotgun, like a kid's shotgun. But it had a big-ass bullet like this. It was a rhino gun. He goes, yeah, but it's got a big bullet. That's what he tried to do. Ew! So pals ran against him like four times. So this is the kind of thing that you're dealing with, this icky gun stuff. What happens? NRA, Charlton Heston, take it from my cold, dead hands, holding the flintlock. 96, Pat Buchanan comes to Arizona. He's at Crossroads of the gun of the West Gun Show, and he's holding, gets a picture in the paper holding up a .30-06 with a scope. L. Neal Smith understood what was going on. Yeah, they're Second Amendment, but not really, okay? If you're not holding up a battle rifle, man, you're just pretending. So SAFE got a reputation of, no. You go talk there, you got to have a color picture. What happened since then? As it becomes part of the norm here in Arizona, you got 50, every politician in the planet, no matter how communist they are, has got to be seen with their 50 caliber penis. See my point? It's a cultural thing. By not compromising, we have changed the culture in Arizona and the planet. No compromise positions here. I give you unrestricted concealed carry. When we did the initiative at the time, another thing is going on too. Jane Hull had just been appointed, moved up from Secretary of State to Governor because Symington got, you know, indicted for whatever the hell during those days. There was a wife of a friend of ours that was coming up from Tucson and had to go to the bathroom really bad, okay? Sacaton Rest Stop, which is just kind of north of Casa Grande there, she pulls in, it's 11 o'clock at night, characters around, you have some pickup truck guys, and she didn't feel comfortable. She had to go to the bathroom. The sign's right in front of her there, she gets out, and she's armed, she always had a firearm, and she used to carry 357. So it said, all firearms must remain in the vehicle. Well, if you go and you got to go to the bathroom, it's 11 o'clock at night, and you're sitting in a stall with your panties wrinkled, and it says, you're mine, he's right. Yeah. And this rhetoric that we're giving the media at the time is going, hey, you know, it's been a John Buttrick, and was fired. I mean, you know, they don't like this Liberian thing. She would call bitch, goes to a rest stop, she gets in, she has her gun in her purse, whatever it was, She goes into the restroom, and there's a big guy comes in, he's got a rope. And he goes, "Oh, we're going to have us some fun."
Oh, why they meant this?
Bitches with guns, man. Okay? So this is the kind of stories you don't hear.
Yeah.
Well, of course, she's on the radio making a big deal. So during all of this, just like what's going on now, this battle that we're going to take it, and then, you know, the stupidity of it, but that doesn't mean they're not going to do it. So we went down, we said, all right, we're going to go down to the Sacaton rest stop and do the same thing that we did in Encanto Park. We're just going to, give our gun a rest. We're going to go to rest stop. So early one Saturday morning, now when we do this, the reason I'm telling you now, we always do this kind of stuff before opening of the legislative session, which is a week from Monday. So what can you do? Because that's when you get on, whatever's in the deal, somebody's going to have an opinion, I got the bill, vote me, okay? I'm a good legislator. Well, we're going there to do this. Well, during this time, they've tried to do the route like you guys always, you go talk to your legislator, and you go, I know the governor, and you're going to this and that. And it built up for months. It had started back in, like, I don't know, August, September or something, and by now it's early January. So what happened is that they're going back and forth. The attorney for the Arizona Department of Transportation sent a letter to one of the guys. It happened to have been a state employee. It was Rick DeStephens. He worked in the same department, whatever you did. See, a lot of people don't know, Powell is a microbiologist. He's a big DNA sequencing, doing kind of head of the bioterrorism lab with the FBI and Arizona State Health, blah, blah, blah. This guy's got some skills, okay? So he knew all this BS, ooh, anthrax, if you need more equipment, to whatever, where am I going to put it? I've got half the shit I paid $1 billion for in the hallway already. I mean, I don't know what to tell you. Hell, somebody's making some money. You better spend it. Okay. So while this is going on, you have state employees are just pissed off, too. There's a lot of gunnies that work for the government, too. So they had their contacts in government, and they start putting the pressure on. Well, it's time to break out the lawyers. We're going to, Arizona Department of Transportation lawyer, De La State something, is going to send a legal opinion or a letter saying, and this is what it said. It goes, like all other private property owners, we can determine the condition under which you use our property. Okay, the rest stops. And I go, these guys have no idea what they are saying. So we took that, made a printed plate of it for our printing press. We love this printing press. We take and we made a plate and we put red bars, that one quote there, so people would zoom in on that. That was one side of the flyer. The other side of the flyer, we're going to the rest stop with our guns. And we did it again, just like with Encanto Park, we put it out everywhere. I get a call from the head of the state police, the Department of Public Safety, Commander Supreme, whatever the hell it is, that we're down at the state cap. Ernie, this is, Lieutenant Commander, whatever the hell he was. What's his name? And I go, you drew the short straw, huh? Because I know what they're going to do, because it's what they always do.
Yeah.
Well, your gathering and your people and your event and your whatever. You know, who's got the microphone? Who's got to get the permit? Okay? And I go, one, I'm just going to the rest stop, and, sometimes people go with me. I'm going to have some hot dogs and, hot chocolate, and you might want to come down and share with us. It's all good. And I go, and I'm in charge of anything.
Nobody.
So I don't know what you're talking about. Well, you're not going to be able to do it without a permit. I go, we're libertarians. We don't get permits. So sure enough, we go down, there's a bunch of us, and we're there, but fortunately, Sacaton, what does that mean? That means you're getting all the television stations from Tucson and Phoenix the weekend before the legislative session. Here they come. Well, they put you on camera, and you're ready. There are three or four of us that, do good interviews, and mine is like, you go to these rest stops, and you have your wife, your mother, your daughter, your girlfriend, they go in and they're unarmed and they're in this stall out in the middle of the nothing and it's dark and they got their pants around their ankles and the guy comes in, oh, this is Burger Droid. And I bet if you look and you watch us, look at the, we didn't even make the effort. You look at the crime statistics and you tell me how many people are there being assaulted by firearms, compared to defending, and where's all this, trouble, why would they look at rape and robbery and assault and rape and at the revenue, holy shit, man, this ain't working out the way we wanted. So this is all we're doing. So what we're going to do now? We'll wait until April. Every week in the month of April, we're going to Sunset Point, Sacaton, a couple of others, going out west or something, We only need three or four. We got all of the winter visitors that were leaving, especially Sunset Point. And you're there all day, man, it's RVs galore, right? So what are we going to do? We're just going to pass out flyers saying you're being lied to. You can carry your farm. You can go in and do it. And we had it all printed up and we're ready to go. We go, oh, here we go. We love it when you guys do this. You more son, ATR, oh, we're changing all the signs. We're ever so sorry. I directed and ordered, and that's not a problem. Don't worry about it. Hey, it's... Okay. That's how you get stuff changed.
Yeah. Bravo.
And it changes the culture. Yeah. Okay? I am much more concerned about the guy that won't hold the detachable magazine, black pistol grip, you know, firearm, than I am worried about whether he's going to get and lay hands on my event by speaking. You know, I don't give a crap. You know, that is not what's... So these guys, who would do that? Well, now they almost all would. I mean, see, I had the gun. Of course, I voted for whatever, but I got a picture of me with a gun. I'm pro-Second Amendment. And I'll give you an example. Jeff Grosskost became Speaker of the House here in Arizona in the mid-90s. He died a few years ago from complicated diabetes or something. But he was good on the Second Amendment thing. He was a safe legislator, okay? He introduced unrestricted concealed carry as a bill. Everybody's going, yay, okay? At the same time, Frances Barwood was a city councilwoman, and she wanted to be a safe councilwoman. They loved the safe thing, right? When we were doing that initiative, all of a sudden they said, you know, we had in like 3 months, volunteer. We had no intention of getting the thing. Before this for a second. Remember when I was talking about that petition? What was that for? You tear this object? It was all just activism. It wasn't the signatures that we were worried about. We had 20,000. We need 20,000 to get 100,000 or 200,000 signatures? No. We used the actual pieces of paper as activism. We were passing those out everywhere. One of them was a repeal of personal property tax, which is like your car tax, you know, your registration fee, right? Repeal of personal property tax, of restrictions on carrying a firearm. One was fully informed jury, and one, this was good. One that we did, of like 30-something initiatives that we did, if the federal government goes over $9 trillion in debt, Arizona secedes. Oh, that'll never happen! And they don't care if we do it then. That was an interesting conversation. See, we look in the future, we know what's happening. We know what's going on. We were young. They're going, yeah, by the time we start out, our kids get to be our age, we know where we're going. And we have an initiative for that. I have an initiative filed with the city of Phoenix since June of 2002. It's still sitting there. Okay? I keep finding no activity reports, not a sends in the financial stuff. We just sitting there. And it said the city of Phoenix can never impose a tax on any internet transaction. Oh, we're never going to do that. I go, fine. Well, here we go. That's going to start, you know, coming up here pretty soon. I only had to wait 10 years. Knew it was going to happen. Okay? So as we're doing this, all of a sudden, we got this initiative out and so on, and we're passing out these flyers, and that's what's getting everybody going. Oh, they find out that we had about 30-something thousand volunteer signatures in 3 months. Now, it's not enough that we're going to go, you know, get the initiative, but it's a good database. Eventually, I took all those and I burned them. Let me tell you why. Remember Shooter's World? They were being all our buddy and everything?
Yeah.
All of a sudden, the owner of the development thing, the head guy, his daughter married this guy. I remember his name was Norton. His last name was Norton. Norton was their lobbyist to the left. Well, which lobbyist was he? Was he developer? Was he Second Amendment? Was he what was he? Well, it was just a money-making thing. He was just legislators, okay? And I think now he works for the, you know, League of Cities and Towns or County, whatever the heck. I mean, it's just one of them. So what happened was, this is what he was doing. It eventually got to the point to where they go, hey, Ernie, tell you what the deal is. Because they passed this permitted concealed carry, it requires that you get training. Shooter's World had built on a wing to their place there that had a whole bunch of classrooms. They knew they were going to make them some money. Hey! But who do you market to? SAFE has got a list of 36,000 people that wanted concealed carry. We want that list. Ernie, we love you.
Yeah.
I need a consultant. Now, this is 94.
Oh, no.
$4 a month. You be our boy, we get the list. Right. I took that list and I burned it. Because I go, I already see where this is going. You're just another list guy. At the same time, it used to be that when a gun was recovered in a crime and it went to the property room of law enforcement, what would they do? They would go and they'd say, all right, it's here, it's gone through the trial, it's done, it's passed, not going to get it. We're going to auction it off. They would have gun auctions, they'd take the money, and it would pay for their range time and their bullets and some, you know, whatever stuff that they were doing for law enforcement, to have Christmas party, hookers, whatever, I don't know. So what they did is they would auction these off. Well, it started off that they would auction off one at a time. You know, people would, I need a gun, I go down, yeah, I want that one, and I'll bid, and it was bidding up. So a gun that would, you know, normally cost you $300, you might be able to get for $100, $150, okay? But bought them in like, you know, 10,000 increments at a time, well then, that, you know, you get a whole bunch of them, well those guns might be, you know, $75, and then you could sell them, you know, for like $200, so you make a lot of money, right? The federal law licensees, the gun retailers, saw law enforcement as a competitor for their free market. So this was their solution. You can only buy guns if you buy $5,000 worth. So who's going to go and buy? Well, some guys would, and some did. Well, that pissed them off too. No. It's $10,000 worth now. Wow. Who was the lobbyist for that? The shooter's world guy.
How do you like that?
Because they want to be able to buy. It's all about monopolizing, you know, commercial, their money thing, right? So this is what we're growing up in. We understand that the gun industry is just bad politically. And it got really bad in 94 when this happened. This is what you expect from the NRA. The NRA makes a call out. And they say, oh, we need all the gunnies. And all the gunnies coming. You guys make a lot of noise, gunnies. We need safe. And I go, I'm not going as county chairman of Liberty. Because I know you guys, you can bite because we ain't doing it. Now, I'll go as safe, you know. So I'll put on my safe hat. So I go in. We're safe. Mike Duggar, Libertarian Second Amendment Caucus, which was kind of a libertarian gun rights thing. He also started a thing called, would you bring me back some more, please? GOLF stood for Gun Owners Liberation Front. Miguel Cartero, which was meant Mike the mailman, you know, Mike is a mailman, he had a vacation for a week, he let his beard grow. And he had this black beret and sunglasses, and he had, you know, the bandoliers that you had the bullets in, like, you know, Mexican. And he had golf tees in them, okay? The logo was golf. An AK-47, you know, they put helmets on, you know, and the soldier guys or whatever. He had a golf ball on it, okay? The Gun Owner Liberation Front, we did pictures of it, and he got all kinds of awards for one of the first political activist websites, okay? Top five. I mean, it was, you know, back in 94. I mean, this is, oh my goodness, he had a picture on a website. And I'm like, how come it's taking an hour to download this picture, man? What the hell? Internet, man, what the hell is this? So I had no idea how it worked. So we had our 2400 baud modems. He's putting the pictures up and everything, and what it was, and he had a picture, imagine this painting turned vertical. And it was an elephant looking back at its butt like this, okay? And what he did is he took two golf balls and he put it in a lane, and he had a golf tee and he had a 44 Magnum revolver as a hammer, and he's like, he's hammering the testicles to the elephant, okay? Gunners over in golf. Give the Republicans the balls they need to reveal this on my Claire Wolf does her book, 101 Things to Do Till the Revolution. We're at that awkward time in America where it's too late to work within the system, but too early to start shooting the bastards. There's an article in the magazine this month, and we're kind of past that too early thing, too. So, what happened was he's a mailman, he understood how it worked. If you take the ankle stocking and you put two golf balls in it, it looks like a scrotum, okay, But you can put a little mailing label on it to Congress, Congressman, what's his face, whatever. And so on. So he goes, tell you what, here's how you can do it. Here's the pictures of how it's done. Or you can send me $5 and I'll do it for you. Boom! Yeah. Boom! Washington mail room is getting a whole bunch of golf balls and ankle stockings. Where the hell did that come from? So this is the kind of stuff that we're doing, all right? The NRA calls us in, they sat us down. I remember it was a room about half this size, and it was kind of a conference room, but they did something weird. It had like bleachers on the side, and then kind of a, thank you very much. They had a thing in the middle, and there was probably 60 people there. And they were really pushing the concept that they were going to have to endorse, and they wanted John Kyle to go from the House to replace Dennis DeConcini's. So, but Sam, I think it was Coppersmith or somebody, well, some Democrat, state chair, or something was running against him. Well, this assault weapons ban is coming up, you know, the vote in 93, they're doing the, you know, all this kind of stuff there. You go, look, we got to get good conservative Republicans in there and so on, and you're better off with, you don't want that evil Democrat. So, the NRA is going to let John Kyle vote for the assault weapons ban and give him an A rating. And we need your help to get petitions and all this other crap, right? And we're there with Scott Granger, a high-quality engineer, owns his own company and planes, flying around the state, running for a U.S. Senate, libertarian out of Mesa, and he's a good guy, right? We're going, well, what about Scott? Oh, no, can't be. It's got to be Republican or Democrat. Later the next year, when we were running candidates for City of Phoenix, they go, well, it's not the questionnaires. Well, of course, you know, libertarians are very good on gun rights, you know, they're liberal, whatever the hell, we can't, you know, give them a good rating. So we're going to give them an L rating. So from then on, we're like, hell, we don't want you to get Kyle votes to the crime, but you give him an A rating? The hell I want an A rating for? I want my L. Right? So we're making a big deal out of this. And all right, then what happens? From my cold, dead hands kind of deal, after they gave Kyle the A-plus rating, what did we do? We went, 3 o'clock in the morning, I just couldn't sleep. I got into the workshop, made big 4x4 and 4x8 signs by hand, and it said, Zeke Kyle! With a blood dripping swastika. And I went and put them on the corners. Took a bunch of colored pictures. Made a shitload of pictures. Went to all these gun meetings and everything, started handing out the pictures. Okay? Then they had a big barbecue in Mesa. We rented a plane, and it pulled the banner and said, welcome to Gun Banner Barbecue. NRA don't like us. Then what happens? The following year, they had their national conference here at the Phoenix Civic Center. We did 2 flyers on our printing press, little trifolds. One said, your gun, your rights, your vote. And it was about how the Brady Bill passed with the NRA support and Bob Dole to get it in and doing, you know, they need something so they'd be against it. And all the background, before the internet, you didn't know this stuff unless you knew. So the NRA was behind the Brady Bill. Yeah. You know, there was all kinds of crap going on with that. So a lot of people don't know this, so we do that flyer. There was another flyer by L. Neil Smith, and it said the 12-step program to get off the NRA. We took hundreds, thousands of those, and we broke up in teams, and right the day before the NRA thing happened, or that morning, we went and slid both of them under every single hotel door of every hotel downtown Phoenix. Within like an hour. You know, you got this floor, you got this floor, you got this floor, boom, 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 boom. When the session started, they went into executive session to stop debate. People bring up, I move, I want, I have point of order, I ask, I want to know about, whatever. Boom, with a gavel. 17 times they went into executive session to stop debate. At the same time, Bob Anderson, he was a life member, so what did they do? They give you a pre, you know, they had a postage paid envelope, you send back a donation or whatever. Well, they paid by weight, so everybody's putting washers in there and everything, you know, and sending it back to them. So it's costing them money. So we're just being real butt heads. Well, what happened, he got a shirt and it says, I am the NRA and I am ashamed. Because remember, there's right? Yeah. At the time, Wayne LaPierre said, well, the jackbooted thugs, referring to BATF. Well, hell, the Gunnies loved that. They thought that was the best thing NRA ever did. Well, what happened was, is that in the late 70s, so there was a battle. We want to just be a shooting thing, kind of working and targeting and training and be part of the government and train people to be good soldiers to go kill people that live in sand places. You know, that's really what the NRA was about. It was, they were worried that, you know, America was losing its shooting edge to be able to kill people for the state. So we need to have them trained so they can go kill people for the state, you know. Well, the other crowd was, no, I just don't want the state to kill me.
Yeah.
So this is where the line was, and the freedom-oriented guys won out. Now, this is, what was his name, Neil Knox, was that his name?
Yeah.
Neil Knox and his son and so on during the night. A lot of this was going back and forth at the time, I remember. Well, trying to push chronology, right? So the NRA, they were really part of the problem, in our opinion. It got so bad that, remember when they're doing the football stadium, it's going to be in Tempe, it's going to be in Mesa, it's going to be here, yeah. There. Some lobby firm had a, Scott Bungard, was that his name?
Yeah.
Scott, you know, I knew him because he kind of hung out with Jeff Grosskost, that was, you know, kind of a SAFE legislator and so on. So he knew me from through Jeff. He goes, hey, Ernie, man, I need you to come meet with these lobbyists. Well, what they wanted is this is like 2000 or something. They wanted to stop the building of the football stadium in Glendale, and we were big against it, doing all kinds of stuff and lawsuits, yeah. And everything, because it was illegal and unconstitutional and how they're going to tax it and they'll rip off and all that kind of stuff, libertarian stuff. Oh, we're with you, man. Oh, we got to stop it in Glendale because we really want it in Tempe. So, I don't know, what the hell's the difference to them? You know, whatever, you know. But they thought they could, because they think this way. You offer enough money, you offer enough. My lawsuit, I would challenge the baseball stadium. I'm in court and all that kind of stuff. The figure got up to $80,000 behind the scenes. So, you know, Tim McDermott, you know, the new guy, you know, sometimes you see him, you know, he was part of that lawsuit at the same time. He was there. Heck, they did it through him to try and see if I'd do it. So I'm just going, I'm like, man, like, you trust him anyway, you know. It's like a leprechaun thing. I wish to be the happiest guy in the village. And poof, in the village idiot. So I don't trust these guys anyway. So what happened was, So this lobby firm brings me in, and I go up downtown, big high rises, big mahogany tables and everything, but it was kind of sterile. It was almost like it was staged, you know? And I'm going, you guys put pictures on your desk or anything? I mean, I go in there, they set me down, they explain how they're going to help me and everything, and they're going to show how powerful they are. This is what they did. I don't know, they didn't know who they were talking to. They go, you know the guy that owns Monster.com? It's like an employment thing or whatever.
Right.
Big handgun control guy, okay? Well, he wanted something. Now, this lobby firm had gone to the NRA and said, look, you need a pro-NRA gun lobbyist here in Arizona. You need to give us a little something, you know, so we can be one of our clients and we'll make sure it's all good. Well, by then, the NRA had been dealing with us. You know, they're like, oh, hell no, we don't go to Arizona, okay? You deal with the state rifle and pistol guys and this and that and kind of our whatever, but we got slapped around. We don't play, okay? So they kind of, you know, stay away with their big giant going to do whatever here. So what happened is they go, oh, yeah, well, they need to have lobbyists for guns. So they take a bill with handguns with the financial support of the Monster guy, and they had to get it past a single committee just to show that they got it through committee. They introduce it. They get their guys all signed and lined up and what committee they're going to do. They get it through committee and go, aha! You need us now, don't you? So the lobby guys is whoever pays them. They don't care. And they're telling me this story, so I know how powerful and connected they are. I'm like, you know what, scumbag. I can't get out of here fast enough. Okay? So this is the kind of stuff that goes on behind the scenes. When we did the rest stop thing and the governor comes out, and you start seeing people are going, ooh, yeah, this is going well. Then, about the same time, it was about 99, around in there, it was right after 9/11. 9/11 happens, Mark Killian is now the director. Mark Killian is now the director of the Arizona Department of Revenue, and he used to be Speaker of the House in the 90s, and I knew him back then, and he taught me one thing, repeat about education rollover stuff and other lawsuits I did and all that kind of stuff. And I said, look, you guys know I'm gonna get you on this. I can't believe you bringing me in. You know, oh, well, I'll talk Ernie down. He won't be all upset and so on. And I go in there and he goes, Ernie, of course we're not gonna fix this. Of course we're not gonna pay this debt. Of course we're not, because nobody cares. And I go, So you're saying if I get the people all worked up and they care, then you care. Yep. I'll be right back. So now he's Arizona Department of Revenue's director. And what happened? After 9/11, they can't get enough metal detectors. They were just like, oh yeah, we definitely going to have one in the Arizona Department of Revenue. Can't have them Arizona people coming in and pay their taxes with guns. Okay? Donna, last month, she would go down and pay in person instead of mailing it, because you get to keep it longer if you go in person, whatever, because screw them. So she would go get her hair done or something that day, and she's a real estate agent. You don't have a beautiful, young, real estate female going in, I'll meet you at the empty house, Lone Prairie, or whatever, and I'm your sex slave for, see? So, you know, she has her 38. So when she goes down in person, she just go in, pay it, and leave. Metal detectors and security guards and stuff, right? So there was a, all right, well, I know the law. Okay, you have to check it. All right, well, here, I check it. Security guy checked it, they can become friends. He wants to talk to me. Come to find out, he'd ride the bus from Tempe to his job at the state capitol up there, the Department of Revenue, which is right by it. He goes, I go up here, it's against the law for me to be, bring my gun on the bus. Yeah. But I got to get here and work, and how do I do it? So we have been working on the bus thing too, so that was another long story. So we kind of, you know, befriended him a little bit. So he's on. So finally it gets to the point, they just hate this. You know, Donna's just pissing them off. So Killian says, no, you can't check it here. Now you gotta, when you come down to pay taxes, okay, you can't check your gun here. You gotta go like a quarter mile or 200-300 yards over to the state capitol building, get the state police to check your gun, then go pay your taxes and go back get your gun. So I'm just, you know, seriously, you know, whenever you just want to chill and run your restaurant, they pull you back in, you know. What was also happening at the same time, there was a woman named Shannon Flynn. Some of you guys may remember this. And Dean remembers, and it was Rick DeStefans, the other guy that Powell knew that was an employee. Rick DeStefans worked downtown for the government, the department or whatever, and big gunny, and what happened, there was a woman named Shannon Flynn that worked in the same building there. She was in her early, mid-20s. She had a concealed carry, 20 millimeter with her, and the reason was, is up until she was 16, her father regularly raped and molested her. Ooh. While he's doing so, whispering in the ear, I'm gonna kill you. I'm always like, I mean, how do you even freaking survive this? He's getting out in 6 months. She's like scared crapless. Her and her husband, they go get training. She gets her firearm. She brings it to work. She has it with her all the time, just so she can function. All of a sudden, the metal detectors affect employees too. You're not allowed to protect. In fact, they said you can't even bring it in your car in the parking lot.
Yeah.
She lived in Apache Junction. She'd be disarmed from her front door to Apache Junction all the way to here and back. See my point? We start making a big deal. Every day for weeks at lunch, state employees that were pro-gunnies would go out and carry signs. His name's Mark Killian. So what did the signs say? The Killian Fields. We had Scott Beezer does some of our artwork. He did a picture. I sent him a picture of Mark and the front of the building. And had him like this. And it said, gun-free zone in the Killian Fields kind of little thing. Oh, that went everywhere. This is what they deal with when they deal with us. Make them pay. Okay? Up here. So as this is going on, they bring Shannon in. They start trying to make a deal with her. They go, look, I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to let you park in the closest parking space to the entrance.
Sure.
And we're going to have a security guard that will walk you to and from your car.
All of that.
Anything to make this gun thing.
Yeah.
Well, at the time, during all this, when she couldn't, she had a knife. Well, the thing is, under 4 inches, you can or something like that. Nope, can't have the knife either. It was just a, you know, our chests is outmoored than yours or something thing that they, it was a deal. So when Donna got involved in this, I'm like, you know, now they're pulling me in, you know? And I'm just, you know, all right, you guys want to play, here we go. Come watch Ernie get arrested. Everybody wants to do that, okay? 60, 70 people came to in front of the Department of Revenue with guitars. They're singing and stuff. They had like 2-3 people with guitars. Signs, guns, and money. And the money was to bail me out. So I would write on the internet, I'm going, look, you guys don't understand what's happening. I guarantee, no matter how many people come, it won't get word one in the media. They'll all be there, they'll all get their video, but in there because it won't have a government number. You have to have an arrest, you have to have a lawsuit, you have to have a government number, it won't get covered. You watch. We get there, and they're worried, you know, and Mark Victor, you know, is there, he's playing my attorney. He goes, let me explain something to you, Ernie. If you go in there, and they say no, and you walk in anyway, it's disorderly conduct, with a firearm, felony. So, now, were they combined in any way? No, but they'll say they are. Okay, they'll just make it up as they go. As I'm in there, and I go, and the TV cameras are there, and they're watching, I'm going, will you check my firearm here? And he's the guy I knew. He's like, you know, no. Are you sure? Yes.
Yes.
As I go, like, here's the desk here, there's the counters over there, there's a big lobby here. And I kind of, you know, go like this and kind of, you know, kind of lean like I'm going to go. All of a sudden, like, little heads come out. It was all the state police. They're going to have them a show. Oh. We'll get us some earning.
Yeah.
Okay? So I'm going, okay, well, thank you. And I walk out front and I go, now do you guys get it? They're going to, you know, blah, 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 blah. Now I have standing. Less than a week, we filed a special action straight to the Arizona Supreme Court. There is a rule that if the government is forbidden from doing something and they do it, or required by law to do something and they don't, you can go straight to the Supreme Court and rid of whatever the hell.
Okay? Yeah.
So I go in and I've done it 3 times, so I went like I didn't know. So I go in and I go, okay. So we wrote this whole big long thing, and what you always get them from the unexpected, perpendicular, but relevant direction, this L. Neil Smith thing. So we're thinking 3, 4, 5 deep. They have no idea what's coming. The reason we did this is at the time, you have all these, you know, progressive, we need to take the guns, gun grabber, whatever the hell people, that have permeated society, and they're attorneys for Walmart. You know, they're on the board of the whatever. Yeah. So what did they say? All the retailers, they're going, we need to ban guns on our property so we are not held solely responsible in case something happens, right? So they thought insurance company, they're thinking they're better off this way. Well, what happens? More people get killed.
That's right.
So what we were making the argument is we're going, okay, some woman gets raped, you know, in the Walmart parking lot and all that kind of stuff. What did we say? We're going, here, we use this lawsuit to make what the law was, what the history was, what the stats were. I mean, it was a big-ass lawsuit. It's on Freedom Speech. I mean, we put it up there. And it has all this information about Walmart should be held to a higher civil liability by banning the guns. And all the case law and all the work and all that takes lawyers and they don't know where to look and they don't understand. And all. We put it all in one nice little package that was filed in Arizona Supreme Court, and here you are. All of a sudden, everything started to change. What did we have? SAFE MAP. Second Amendment is for everyone. Merchant Awareness Program. And it was 2 cards. We'd have like 2 business. A business card with a perforation, and underneath it, it had another business card. So it would be like this. There's a perforation, you tear it off, you'd hand one to the manager, you can't have that gun, okay, well here's your safe map, okay, you can walk out. On there, it said, this is why we're doing this, you're making us less safe, we will respect your property rights, it's a libertarian thing, you can set whatever deal you want on your property, you know, you can get me for trespassing, you don't want me there because I, you know, have a gun, don't have a gun, you know, black or blue-eyed, whatever, I don't care. You know, it's your property as far as I'm concerned, okay? So that's a libertarian thing. You can do whatever you want. But we get the boycott. Ooh. See, that's why we were like, you know, this civil rights thing and so on. No, no, no. You know, it's much better to be in a position to respect their rights and you just tell everybody not to shop there or they shouldn't because they're racist or whatever. But you don't want government involved because then you get all kinds of strings, okay? So we're saying, look, you have a perfect right to ban guns on your private property, but we're going to tell everybody, okay? And you should be held to a higher civil liability. Everybody knows that you know, you've been informed, you understand this. This would be part of a civil case later if something happened. One part, it was you filled out where it was, what the manager's name were, who you were, and so on, and you mailed it to SAFE, and we put that location up on a map on the internet. These are the places to go, these are the places not to go. John Green was president of the Senate. He got his concealed carry. He goes in the Metro Center Mall or something. They say, hey, you can't bring your gun in here. Well, I'm a legislator, and I got my permit, and I'm... He was pissed off. He wanted to pass a law to make them let them bring their gun in. Well, what do the libertarians do? SAFE comes up and we go, no, 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 no. That's not how it works. It's their property and do what they want. You know, we're here to protect the right of Metro Center not to let gun owners bring their guns in. And to inform you that Christel Mall will. Get it? All of a sudden, Metro Center, you know, well, maybe it's not that big a deal. So I wanted to have this the unrestricted concealed carry thing really came in because people were just carrying openly because they refused to get the permit. They wanted it in mind. It really wasn't that big a deal. They just wanted it to be, hell, they knew they were going to be safer because the culture had informed them of that. They were starting to see it. Lawsuits were being done. You disarm him. It was a culture thing. This is the point that I'm making. You go, how the hell is it that Arizona all of a sudden got unrestricted concealed carry from whatever? Well, now you know why. You know, that was just the tip of the iceberg. We have 50 gazillion of them. We did a reach out and touch someone raffle, okay? And the logo was Bambi wearing a UN helmet with crosshairs. Get my point? We sold a bunch of tickets just because they wanted a ticket. So this is the kind of stuff that we've been doing. In the meantime, we know the law enforcement. They know we're principled on this. They know reasons why we do this stuff. And it's not because we're evil, we oppose, and whatever. We give them every opportunity. We look to them to protect our rights. We look to them to be the good guys. When Chris did the black man AR-15 thing, Obama's here a couple of years ago, we had been talking to the police department what we were going to do 3-4 days before. You know, Al Ramirez from the police department, he was standing 5 feet in front of me while CNN's doing all their crap. And all their footage they got from our video on YouTube. They're going, well, we see right here you were behind, and isn't that you were the gun? You got one. You know, I'm going, where the hell do you think you got this video? We're the ones that did it, morons. You know, so this is, you should go watch it. CNN and Ernest Hancock, you'll get entertained, you know. Because they wanted to get you. You know, ooh, you had bad, evil gunning people. And we're going, no, we worked with the police. Hell, they were supportive. We're keeping all the progressives out there screaming in your ear with a megaphone doing their crap and so on. We're keeping everything peaceful because they wanted to cause a ruckus. And it was funny this. It was like 3rd Street, Washington or something, and you had this big intersection. This is where the protest, where the media is going to be. The Republicans were on the far corner over there. J.D. Hayworth and crowd had some big morning meeting at some bar or tavern or something, and they're going, this is in the morning, this is like 8 in the morning or something. And they're coming over, and they haven't got to the corner yet. The Democrat corner is kind of going across from them. They were coming in buses from Tucson. I mean, they had all the liberals from Tucson. They, you know, got the unions, never been there, coming in the buses and healthcare. Okay? Well, we were there early because I had the radio show to do. We're doing my remote Comrex thing, and I'm doing the show. We're here to do it. So my son and his friends and a bunch of other actors, so we probably had a couple dozen guns there, you know? So I'm wearing my 9mm. Chris says, you know, hey, Ernie calls me Saturday. He goes, I'm going to bring my AR-15. What am I going to say? No. I'm like, hey, you're on your own. Fine, don't expect me to go jump in front of you because I'm, you know, have a nice day. So S locked and loaded, and magazine extra, and his 9mm, and he's looking all Louis Farrakhan-y and everything. He's just and a lot of times, you look on the site, you'll go to safegunowners.org, and you'll see that there is a JPFO films that go to no guns for Negroes, no guns for Jews, okay? And these are, you know, it tells you the history of gun control and how it is, because the freed slaves after the Civil War, you know, they got rights now. Oh, man, them's the uppity blacks with guns. We can't have that. So the Ku Klux Klan and them go, no, we gotta have gun control to where you ask permission of the sheriff whether you can have a gun. And guess what? You can't, because they come lynch you, okay? So, but you start to see that armed blacks during the 60s riots and all this other stuff, Black Panthers, the Deacons, all these guys, when Martin Luther King, they don't tell Martin Luther King is marching and doing, the only ones that they didn't get beat up at were with the Deacons. This black older gentleman came with shotguns, and they're the ones that are protecting them. They don't tell you that part, okay? So then, of course, they need some assassinations. They got to get some RFK and Martin Luther King and everything, gets gun control 68. That served the black community? Hell no. So that's what JPFO, they put this stuff out in the movies. So there's, I can go on and on and on about these stories. But the point is that I want to tell you some of these stories because SAFE is going to resurrect itself. I put it out, I put a special edition, I have the webpage domain, it sits over there, it waits for stuff like this. When, you know, the NRA, you can count on them being communist, you know, and coming out and being wimpy. Because I'll tell you, I knew they were going to do this. I knew it. They get up, well, our solution is you should have a government armed thug at every school. Yeah. I'd rather the teacher, hell, they don't have, you know, attacks anymore. They got, you know, they go on field trips, you got the teacher with her battle rifle on her back. So the thing is, I'm going, maybe we don't have to go that far, but at least allow them. Whenever there has been, it hasn't been a mass shooting when there was some teacher or principal or off-duty somebody or something that with a gun to stop the guy from having all the mass shootings. It's list after list after list of these. In fact, one of the articles in this month's magazine is that very issue. Here are all the mass shootings that didn't happen because when they came in, they got shot.
Oh, yeah, I didn't remember.
You know, so, I mean, time after time after time, Pat, read it, okay? So the thing is, you know, so then we have, as we do this, we were ready for them to do this because we've always known that they need our guns. Paul Craig Roberts was part of the administration in the Reagan administration. He's real good, but the bad guys are being bad. He went on Russia Today, RT.com, whatever, he's up there, but I know. An armed populace and a police state are incompatible. And they're going to have their police state.
Oh, yeah.
That's what's coming.
Yep.
And whatever way they're going to do it, that's the plan.
That's the plan.
Are they going to be able to get away with it? I don't know. The point is that SAFE is resurrected. I've been thinking a lot about, you know, what can we do in 13? I got a bunch of things to do and we got to do and stuff to do. But the thing is that in 13, this is what we're thinking about. You remember the trash can flyers that we do? Yeah. Did you look? What do we put on the back? We can put Freedom's Phoenix on there, SAFE. We can put We Know the Truth and the Bandit and this and that and whatever. We also have this, you know, done a bunch of the DVDs that we do. We're putting these DVDs on one DVD. We're compressing them on the one DVD. It's Nick. He's been putting it together already. So what happens is we're going to have, I have like 30, 40,000 blank DVDs left over from the Levolution. We've done a couple hundred thousand. So I'm going to go ahead and do a, you know, just these films, you know, just why there's guns, just an information stuff, education deal. So we're going to put those up. I talked to Larry Pratt from Guns of America. They want to work with us and so on. So, and Charles Heller, I had him on. He's the new executive director for JPFO. But Aaron Zellman died a couple of years ago. And Jews for the Preservation of Firearm Ownership is, you know, man, they were hardcore. And now they might be playing a little mamby-pamby. Aaron's gone. But the whole reason that they were around was, he goes, look, how is it that so many Jews, well, it had to happen. They disarmed them first. So I just found this out. I knew there was a guy. I didn't know they were related. Dodd, now, what, senator or something, you know, Dodd?
Chris Dodd.
Chris Dodd?
Chris
Dodd. Is there a Dodd now?
Yeah.
Yes.
He's the son.
Well, he's retired.
Well, no, he's retired.
Okay, his father, back in the 60s, and I think he was an attorney during the Nuremberg trials or something, and he knew about the Nazi gun control. So when they wanted to do gun control in 68, they just had that translated from the Library of Congress, and it became the 68 Gun Control Act.
Yeah,
this is common knowledge, you guys in the gun community. They know, you go look at it, there it is. Is that the one that has the translations?
Side by side.
You go like this.
You go online and get
you look at gun control, gateway to tyranny, Nazi weapons law, and it has German, English. German, English. German, boom, 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 boom. They took the Nazi gun control and they made it the 1968 Gun Control Act. And this is what Jews for the Preservation, thank you, for the Preservation of Firearms Ownership knew.
Bernie, what year was that done in Germany?
38. So this is, it's always been, it's not about guns, it's about control. So all the progressives are going to get a lesson. Now we had Randy Rhodes. You remember Randy Rhodes? Randy Rhodes, big progressive and everything. She's coming to Arizona, and she's kind of, you know what? I carry a 38, man. She's like, yeah, the guns, you know, now we understand with the Bush years. During the Bush years, from, you know, 2000 to 08, all and Charles and I is on Air America and everything, we're starting to hear, now we understand why the libertarians are so pro-gun. Now, of course, when the Democrat gets in there, we won't be that way, but when the Republicans in there, we want to have guns. So this was, you know, we can see, it's a cultural thing, and they have overplayed their hand. They are so far removed from the sentiments and the understanding of certainly the new revolution that's coming up, you know, from, you know, Ron Paul and all this other stuff. They think, and they're right, if they don't do it right now, they ain't never gonna do it. But they are of the mindset that they think through administrative stroke of the pen, like they did, like Deeb was talking about, by just executive order, by whatever the hell they can interpret and do whatever, that they can just take your guns away. Because they don't want you out there just exercising your rights. They don't want, and I tell you, I'll finish. There's so many other stories and stuff, but I'll finish with this one. When Chris was standing there, black man with an AR-15, weeks before, the Southern Poverty Law Center had been here saying how we're all racist and we need to get the white supremacists with guns away because of black people for fear of their whatever. Okay? So when you had on MSNBC, you have a guy, a black man with an AR-15 there saying, when you plunder my generation till there's nothing left to plunder, sooner or later there will be resistance. That was the message. And they sure as shit didn't want that coming from a black man. So what did they do? Anybody remember what they did? What they did? They never showed he was black. MSNBC would crop it and cut it and do it, and it was not a black man. It's just a man with an AR-15. It was stupid of them to even try.
It has to be the Breakfast Club.
Did they call a white supremacist?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. The white supremacist. Oh, and the other thing that they did is they were saying, CNN, they were, no. Not the black man that was there at AR-15. What about the white guy? There was no white guy. They just make this crap up as they go along. So when I go on with Rick Sanchez on the gold show, he goes, look at y'all, he's hard. Buddy, you know, I'm just being all kind of nice. Golly, I don't know what the problem is. The Phoenix police are there to protect our rights. They protect our rights here in Arizona. They're the heat. See, that was the deal I had with them. I go, you guys protect our rights, I'll make you heroes. So what they do? The guy that was in charge of that department that came to our workshop that we talked to and we told how this was going to work. We weren't asking permission. We were just saying, this is what's going to happen. However you guys want to deal with this. He's replaced with another guy. And the guy they replaced him with is the guy that did the Phoenix Occupy, and we're going to get him. Oh, all right. I got to tell this one more thing. This is what we knew was happening, and we just got confirmation this last week. Naomi Wolf did an article for The Guardian in the United Kingdom. We couldn't understand these people. We knew what was going to happen. What always happens. You have the Occupy, whatever comes out, and we want, and you can't, and we're just here to whatever, okay? Well, probably half or more of the people that attended the Phoenix Occupy thing were Republicans. Conservatives wanted to have their sign. and a bunch of Love-Illusionaries that were there passing out thousands of DVDs and QR bumper stickers, this and that and everything, and talking to these other young people, the progressives, and giving them DVDs on Ron Paul and freedom of fascism, and talking to them, going, we can't believe that you guys would go and, you know, associate with those Occupy Wall Street people. Well, of course, for the same reason we go to the Tea Party. It's a captive audience, somebody that might want to know something, we're there to help. I don't give a crap what they're thinking. You think I'm turning to the stage, listening to any bullshit they're saying? You know? I don't care. It's the crowd. So we go with all sort of peace and young people and everything and have a good time. And through the marijuana issues and so on, I knew a lot of the people. The head of the movement thing, they were saying that they weren't going to let them stay there after 6 p.m. that evening. That they had to leave. Well, we're going to tell you what we're going to do. We're going to escort you to Mayor Hans Park.
Mayor.
So you can stay there later. But then you got to leave at 10 or 11 or whatever it was. I go, if you leave here and you go there, they will arrest you there. I just want you to know this. They don't want you here. They're not going to arrest you. They don't want the big spectacle in front of City Hall here. They don't want that. They're going to march you, and you're willingly going to go to the train platform. Go to this park, and then they're going to arrest you. And that's exactly what they did.
Really?
During this time, we knew it was going to happen. I ran back to my studio. I'm on the air live. Drew and Nick are down there reporting on the phone live with me video and doing Ustreams and Facebooking and doing all their smartphone crap. As this is going on, we had also a feed of a chat that people were just doing right as they're doing it. There, blah, blah, blah. This news was going out ad live as it was happening. When I was there, the new guy that they put in charge of this confrontation prevention squad, social, whatever the hell it is, this guy, he used to be on the protection team, that guy, sniper guy helping some dignitary come to the president, and he's one of those guys. You will respect my authority, people. Not working with the community, not respecting right, not doing the law. I'm for the freaking government, and I'm not here to help, okay? So I can tell this guy, I had a couple of meetings with him, I can tell his mentality. And one meeting they had at Starbucks, they wanted to meet with me on, I don't know, see what I can't remember what it was. And he goes, how do you know? I remember the day. It was the Monday that gold went to 1900. They go, how do you know? I go, what did gold do today? I go, how's your pension doing? How's your retirement? How's everybody else's? That's how I know, okay? And you guys are gonna do everything what you gotta do to protect yours, and I'm kind of, so what happens? They have that Iron Brotherhood, that motorcycle gang of just cops that are loyal to the Brotherhood, okay? Glendale guys up at Whiskey Row a couple of weeks ago, they beat the crap out of them, call the cops. You see, it's all cops that were beating them up. That kind of went away. We keep checking on that, too. So as we're down at the Occupy thing, Chris, they all pushing it, he has his gun. He's walking around in there, got my gun. They go, oh, you can't have your gun. Well, haven't we gone through this before? Okay, we know that event you can have your firearm. Well, what they had done, and I go to Mike, I think his name was, and I said, you know I'm going to find out what's going on here. I mean, you know that, right? I mean, you will know. It's like, seriously, you guys lied to me on this talk. Did they change the order, change the laws or something? As far as I remember, man, I've checked it, but, I mean, are you sure? They retroactively went and changed permits for the park, because if you're an event holder, you can say, okay, I'm not going to have guns at my private event, okay? That's how they do the Mill Avenue Street Fair and all that kind of stuff. They'll say this whole Tempe is all one event under a semi-quasi-private, almost kind of sort of government thing where we can ban guns. I mean, we've gone through all this stuff with them. They come with all kinds of gymnastics they do. So they go in, they had to retroactively put dates and times that somebody had the morning of the park before they got there that banned guns, and that kind of extended into kind of this confusing thing. Wow. They're just making it up as they go along. So we're going, okay, who's standing on the sidewalk, outside the park on the sidewalk? JT Reddy border militia guys. And they're full glove regalia, man. I'm like, whoa. You know, your punishment is you got to stand there. Okay? So JT's doing his thing, and of course he gets, off and whatever will happen with him. But so they're standing there doing that stuff. And I'm like, yeah, whatever. It was just a show. It was a game. Hell, it's come to find out, man, he may have been a provocateur working for the whatever anyway. You know, they need each other. They got to do that kind of stuff. And it was so obvious to me. I'm telling the guys, don't go to the park, they're going to arrest you, you're not going to get to do what you want, really wanted to do, blah, blah, blah. At the time, city councilmen are going, don't do this, don't arrest them, don't this, don't that, can we have a vote, can we do it? They don't run it. The city manager does. And I'm like, how is it that they're doing this when the city council's telling them not to? So that became the thrust and focus of my investigation, talking on the radio, making a big deal in Phoenix, and so on. I am chief of staff of Hal DeKaiser. Hal DeKaiser used to be the editorial page editor of the Tribune papers. He was the first editor in 1991 or something that ever published anything. They wanted me to write an article because I was in the middle of the ass scam thing and I do whatever. So that's how I knew him from way back. He's known that I've been hardcore, no compromise, some bit from the beginning. So now he's chief of staff for one of the city councilmen. In 2000, I wrote an article about, you know, what I knew was coming. It was called Voting Never Freed Anybody, because they wanted me to write an article for the Tribune to get everybody to go vote. And I'm like, you're talking to the wrong guy. So I did this, you know, article. He knew this. And I said, you remember the parts in that article about sooner or later, people are going to be in the streets demanding their freedom regardless of any vote totals. And you're going to need the libertarians to negotiate with the anarchists. And I did some other stuff, details, and it described exactly what happened at the Occupy thing a couple days before. Did I predict this? This is exactly what I'm talking about. So all of a sudden I said, I got one question for you, Hal. The city council, I just want to know one thing. Who is in charge? What we knew is that Department of Homeland, whatever, were paying the overtime and money and everything of the law enforcement, and they were making money on the deal. So, of course, we were mercenaries. Yeah, we'll pay overtime, we'll get some law enforcement from Phoenix, Glendale, whatever, we'll go whip ass in our nameless, badgeless, faceless, shielded, whatever, whip butt thing. And they were training. They would surround the guys on a basketball court, this one part, they had their big, long shields, and then it was hut, hut, hut. Boom, over somebody, yank them out, boom, next guy, boom, boom, okay, that's what was going on. So we're going, okay, so Chris refused to identify himself, I ain't giving you shit, I know who you are. I ain't volunteering my name, man, nothing. So they put him in the paper, oh no, everybody, so it's just a game they play. Well, Naomi Klein, she involves Occupy Wall Street thing. Regardless of what you think about whether they should, whatever, is not even the point. This is what happened. Through freedom of information requests, is when they find out this. From the 90s, we've been screaming about this multi-jurisdictional task forcing stuff. You know, federalizing local police. They're not in charge. They're not going to be listening to. They're going to do whatever the bad guys want them to. And here it happened. In this freedom of information, they found out that sitting at the big giant mahogany table, how we're going to whip ass on, you know, threat to Homeland Security, Occupy kind of crap is, what they're going to do is they had Department of Homeland Security working with the FBI down to the fusion centers, multi-jurisdictional task force, local law enforcement. There it was. Funding from the federal government, regardless of what the city council said, and who else was sitting at that table supplying my bank accounts, information on all the people and targeted, and this guy and that one had the money and everything. Who was there supplying that information at the top to all of this law enforcement? The banks. That's good to leave on. You know, it's a cultural thing. We're going to be doing a lot of stuff with the trash cam, whatever. You guys want to play, just keep going to safegunowners.org. Here we go, because it's humming. Yep, you got it.
Okay, this is a drawing for the books. First choice. I can read it. 3255. 255. No takers?
3255.
What are we at? Okay, first chance, the books are back there on the corner table. Good. 3274. 3274. One more.
Let's give this young lady over here in the corner and let her draw one.
It was just temporary.
Which one? Three two seven two. You get that?
Yep.
Did you see? I got it. Got it.
Nice.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your contributions and your time. We'll see you next month, the first Saturday.
Oh yeah, that was good too. You better have contributed. Seriously.
Hey, don't be discouraging.
We had a fat contribution today, and we thank you very much.